powered from the Perdomo Cigars Studios on the Black Stage in Indian Trail, North Carolina, and broadcasting from the Drew Estate Studios in California. It's episode 162 of the Primetime Show. Tonight, we welcome the one and only Jean-Michel Louis of De Los Reyes Cigars as our special guest. And as always, the Primetime Show is sponsored by De Los Reyes Cigars. De Los Reyes Cigars introduces another chapter of the saga Solez. Solez is a Spanish word that means leisure after work. In the spirit of the standing ideal of owning your own journey and making your own saga, Saga Solez is the perfect companion to enrich those moments of choice, making them truly yours. Saga Solez carries a blend of Criollo Olor and Piloto Cubano, wrapped in a selected Ecuador Shade Claro wrapper that generously delivers with elegance a surprisingly rich and balanced smoke. It's available in three sizes at an affordable price. Ask your retailer for Saga Solez. And by Perdomo Cigars, awarded Nicaraguan Cigar of the Year in 2014 by Cigar Journal, the Perdomo 20th Anniversary brand has consistently earned the highest scores in the industry and is a top seller in humidors around the world. The Perdomo 20th Anniversary blend requires tobaccos that have been carefully hand-selected and are well-aged for a minimum of 8 years. Perdomo 20th Anniversary is offered in three distinct wrappers, a smooth, creamy Ecuadorian Connecticut, a rich, earthy Cuban seed Nicaraguan sun-grown, and a dark, oily Cuban seed Nicaragua Maduro. Combining these beautifully bourbon barrel-aged wrappers with thick, high-priming binder and filler tobaccos gives each blend a balanced complexity with layers of rich flavors and smooth, elegant aromas. Perdomo Cigars is a family-owned and operated company headquartered in Miami, Florida, with manufacturing and agricultural facilities in Esteli, Nicaragua. Perdomo's highly acclaimed cigar brands include Perdomo Estate Selección Vintage, Perdomo Double H 12-Year Vintage, the Perdomo 20th Anniversary Line, the Perdomo Reserve 10th Anniversary Line, Perdomo Abano Bourbon Barrel Age, Perdomo Lot 23, and many more. For great tasting notes and pairing information, check out the new Perdomo website at www.perdomocigars.com. And by Miami Cigar & Company. Nestor Miranda said it best, there's a mystery and depth to Africa that captivates my spirit, always drawing me to come back. This cigar, Don Lino Africa, captures the way going there makes me feel. Cigar making is an art form, but in the moment when the cigar becomes art itself, you have something special. Don Lino Africa returns from Miami Cigar & Company, the brand you remember blended even more masterfully this time in partnership with tobaccalier A.J. Fernandez. It's an exotic, complex blend meant to mesmerize. It's available in five box press vitolas. Don Lino Africa returns. Ask for a local retailer. And by Drew Estate. Check out and download the Drew Diplomat app for your mobile device. Keep up with everything going on Drew Estate. Experience the subculture that is the rebirth of cigars. Available on iTunes or Google Play. For more information, check out www.drewdiplomat.com. And as always, all the live streaming for the Primetime Network of shows, as well as the California studios on the Primetime Show, is sponsored by Drew Estate. Well, welcome, everybody. This is Primetime, episode 162. Today is Thursday, October 29th, 2020. This is Will Cooper. I am in the Perdomo Cigar Studios on the Black Stage in Indian Trail, North Carolina. And I'm joined cross-country by my friend and colleague, Mr. Aaron Loomis.
How are you doing tonight, Will?
Yeah, I'm doing good. I guess we had a tropical storm blow through here. In the Charlotte area today. And I was telling people, I have this theory. Like I was telling, you know, John McTavish, who works with Aaron on developing palates, I would say he is the cigar media meteorologist. Would you kind of agree with that?
I would agree with that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. John is definitely, like, he follows all these weather patterns. And we get weather updates from Calgary more than I get the weather here. it's true. But so I said to him, I said basically, you know, every time a hurricane hits the U.S., the rains find their way to Charlotte, even if it's Florida, pushes up. If it's in Texas or the Gulf, it pushes northeast. And this one that hit the Gulf, I guess, I fully expected the rain to kind of come through this area. What we didn't expect was the wind that came through, which was pretty bad, is what I'm going to tell you. There was I was really fortunate. I had a couple of trees taken down at the beginning of the month. And I'm really glad. I don't think those trees were getting ready to fall over at some point. Yeah. So I think that preactive move was key. But there was furniture blowing in the backyard. My grill was like wobbling. It was even that. It was surreal. I can tell you that.
Yeah, I heard that it moved pretty quickly across the states. So it was you know, faster than most storms do.
Yeah, I mean, about 7 o'clock in the morning, it was kind of blowing, but by noon, it was gone.
Yeah.
And I know Atlanta got hit harder than we did because that storm, I think, was still had a lot of power when it went through Atlanta. So I was talking to some folks in Atlanta, and they have more like overhead power lines than we have in Charlotte. It has a lot more underground power lines, which helps out here a lot. Yeah. So that was my day today otherwise.
Well, show 162 is a good number for us since we're baseball fans. So it's
right. We went to a whole baseball
season.
Yeah, the regular season, and you know, yep. What's interesting, Aaron, is if you you know, every show we've done 162 shows in a row, we have talked about Saga Cigars to open the show. That's the way we've opened the show every one of the 162 episodes.
That's right.
So as we come to the conclusion of this baseball season, or if you want to put it into the minds, what better way to kind of mark the occasion to have our friend great guy to us in the industry making his primetime debut. I'm thrilled about this tonight. Jean-Michel Louis of De Los Reyes Cigars. Jean-Michel, welcome to primetime.
Well, thank you. And good evening. I don't know if you can hear me. Can you
yes. hear me? Yep. Sound good.
We hear you great.
I have to say I love your shirt.
Which one, mine or Aaron's?
Of course.
I mean, I'm waiting. Let me get, which one is Pro Cigar again?
That okay,
one.
Yeah, yes. Okay. I just want to make sure. I'm thinking.
Well, yeah. Aaron, your shirt is beautiful, just not as much.
No, it was and the funny thing is Jean-Michel's hearing me talk about like 35 mile an hour winds, right? And this guy lives in the Dominican Republic and has probably seen storms five times as strong as me, and I'm whining about these 30 to 35 mile an hour winds here.
No, don't worry. It's part of the Caribbean. We actually enjoy hurricanes here because it means that we're going to have rain.
Right.
So all the agriculture goes, yes. And hurricane season is supposed to be there just before we actually plant tobacco. And so that the soils get actually a little bit richer. So hurricanes, it's part of life, really.
Yeah.
And really, I live in the North Shore. And in the North Shore of the DR, we're pretty safe. In the other coast, it's another guess. But in the North Shore, we have three big chains of mountains, and usually the center one being really, really high, like higher than most hurricanes, and that's like a very nice line of defense.
Yeah, and I remember what you were telling me you lived in the north when we were down there, and I'm like, you have like a pretty big commute to work. It's not because you commute to Santiago, which is more towards the central part of the country.
Correct. I live on the coast.
Yep.
In Puerto Plata. And I go to work every day in Santiago, in the middle of Cibao Valley, so I have to go through the northern chain.
Yeah.
It's actually really nice. I mean, I could complain, I could bitch about it, but seriously, it's pretty nice. And sometimes, you know, in the morning, you feel like it, you stop the car, sit down on the hood, and start your cigars. Then when your cell phone explodes inside the car, you have to go to work. That's the rule.
Yeah, and you were nice enough to drive me a lot when I was down there, and I can tell you, Jean-Michel's car, it's got the cigars. You got cigars there. You got great music you were playing on the satellite radio. So it was a very enjoyable experience, at least the times we were. And there were times we were in the car in Santiago, and I thought it was going to be like an hour before we got there with some of the traffic. So,
hey, when you got there that evening, we actually had a citizen protest that night against the government.
Yeah. Well, we hit one.
Remember that?
The gala. Yeah, we hit one when we went to the gala. Yeah.
And that's actually very interesting. We probably can give lessons to a lot of people because you felt very safe during the whole process. It was absolutely not dangerous. And people were actually protesting. It was like the 30th night they were protesting.
It was. And I don't, you know, we've had protests down here, obviously. That was a true peaceful protest. And I know I've talked to people after I said, the fact that, you know, that was a very good thing to allow. It was a pain in the neck for us because we were trying to get into the gala, but it was, I never saw anything like that before in the U.S. I mean, every protest I've seen, unfortunately, has not been like that. So
My simple explanation is that Dominican people are really nice. I mean this.
No, they really are.
Not people who are prone to, they're really, really nice people.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it was excellent. They were everyone. The hospitality there was fantastic. But we're very glad we have you on the show, tonight. So, Now, I'm drawing a blank, okay? And I want to ask this before we start. The two characters that we say you're a cross of, one was Pepe Le Pew. Who's the other one? I can't remember who it is.
This is old stuff. Yes, I remember. This was a long time ago in the northern part of the United States. And effectively, the contest at that time on that particular show was which two characters my persona is based on. And I believe it was Pepe Le Pew and Hans Gruber.
That's what it was. Yes, Hans Gruber. Yes.
America's favorite villain.
That's who it was. Yes.
I think it's more the accent than the looks. I mean, I look a little bit like Pepe Le Pew, but, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, good job. Good boy. I was drawing a blank all day.
He is my favorite villain. Though.
Oh, he's a great villain. I mean, it absolutely probably in the top three for sure with me. But no, we're really glad to have you, Jean-Michel. We haven't had you on the show before. It's been a long time since I interviewed you as well. But we always like to start the show off in terms of, what was your first experience like smoking a cigar? Do you remember that? And what can you tell us about it?
Well, first of all, I was born in Belgium, in Brussels, way before I came to the Dominican Republic. And of course, the cigars we had on hand were Cubans. The daily driver of my father was a Belgian cigar called Corps Diplomatique, which probably has ceased to exist. It was made with short fillers of Cuban cigars. And it was really the cheaper daily around. So thank God I didn't start with that one. I probably stole, if I remember well, it was a metallic tin of Romeo and Julieta. And there were three cigars in there, if I remember well. I remember there was a logo you would push inside and it would open the tin. And those were my first cigars. Because after I did try the Belgian Corps Diplomatique, and I'm sure it's a great daily driver, but it probably would not have encouraged me to go deeper into premium cigars, such a age, which of course was the legal age, of course, just in case somebody's watching. But that's really all. I mean, I did smoke cigarettes, a whole lot of them. There was a time in my life where smoking cigarettes, I would put my cigar down to have a cigarette. That's how bad it was.
Oh, wow.
But I mean, I'm close to 20, I'm 19 years cigarettes free.
Congratulations,
that's great.
Oh, it's very simple to keep because it was so hard to give it up that I will never go into that footsteps again, ever. I don't want to go. It's a miracle I still have friends. Let me put it this way. But anyway, that was really my first experience. I come from a culture where effectively every good cigar had to be a Cuban cigar. The only thing you could pair with it was cognac, of course. And, you know, I found myself in the Dominican Republic having evolved, gladly so. I still have access to cognac and Cuban cigars, but I enjoy way more the finesses and the possibilities of every Dominican offer I have handy. And definitely, I have turned into a rum guy.
Oh, wow.
I noticed a couple of years ago when I was dusting off my drinks collection and I had a lot of expensive bottle of cognac, but a few bottles of cognac were expensive that I never opened. Because when I felt like a drink, I would take something else. That's, you know, when your instinct talks, that's it. There's a moment where you have to say, okay, I'm a Ronero. I'm done with cognac. I'm not really done with cognac. I mean, I slow down.
Yeah.
Nice. So how does a Belgian guy land in the Dominican Republic?
Well, there is no good answer to this, but I can tell you. There was a time in Belgium where we still did the military duty. I didn't enjoy particularly doing it. And I know that's not American law, but I didn't enjoy it because it was mandatory. You know, there is a difference when you sign for something and there is a difference where you say you're going there, whether you like it or not.
Right.
There's a big difference. I did what I had to do. I think I had very good notes there. They actually wanted me to stay on. Again, being forced to, I couldn't dream of leaving as soon as I could. And I was in Germany. when the Belgian army's effort to contain the forces of the Eastern Europe was essential. And a friend of mine was doing the same duty, but in the French army. His father invested some money in the Dominican Republic. No, at that time, and we're talking mid-80s, Dominican Republic, nobody knew where it was in Europe. You could say Haiti and people would know, but Dominican Republic, no, there was no flights coming straight from Europe, really, impossible. So to me, it was like a whole adventure. For me, it was, you know, I sit down, I decided, my body's going there. It seems like an adventure. Yeah, I'm doing it. And basically, I came here. The business of his father didn't do exactly what it needed to do. But I started in hotels and definitely in airlines, and that airlines brought me to cigars. That's the short version.
Thanks.
Right. When was the Reyes family your first job in cigars?
No, well, not at all. Really, okay. I mean, I'm brought to cigars because I was taking care of cargo for the people of Davidoff. Mm. It was a company. And I was operations in a company called Martinair to Holland. And that was at this time the port of entry in Europe to redistribute the cigars and put the right stickers in the right place for every different market. And that's how I sit down in operational because there was a lot of logistical nightmares and lots of meetings were organized where anybody in the chain of logistics was there. Then you get to meet interesting people. And then when you smoke cigars and you meet interesting people before it gets to be fashionable, it's something you stick with. So I opened my own cigar shops. And I had cigar shops in the DR, probably at that time, definitely the only serious ones. I believe Cigar Aficionado published an article where they said, don't buy cigars in the Dominican Republic. We were really poorly organized at that time. There were lots of fame and everything.
Oh, wow.
So, but if you have to, this is the shop. And they mentioned my shop. And to me, that was like the biggest. I mean, I was nobody in the DR here. It was really interesting. But that's what really brought me to the Reyes because, I mean, I know lots of manufacturers here. I know them all. I mean, this is a tight community. We're really, even though I'm the weird Belgian, you know, after being there, you know, years-decades, yeah, there's a moment. Our paths cross, we talk, and we all know each other. But I knew them all, but I had my shops, and I was easy there. Then we had the 2008 crisis, and I survived with my shops longer than I should after the financial crisis. Because basically, I was picking up everybody else's business, so we're going bankrupt, and I was doing stuff right. But when I finally decided to close my shops, and I was really, truly, truly heartbroken at that time because that was what I wanted to do. I mean, be around cigars, tobacco, right. Was in the field all the time, knew everybody. I mean, it was fun. And then Augusto Reyes, Dirka's father, called me. And man of a simple word, it was late at night, and he asked me, said, I heard you're closing all your shops. And I answered something in the line of, yes, so what, but in a very rude tone. Like really rude. I was heartbroken. I mean, anybody, I would have picked the fight anywhere with anybody. I mean, I was really hard. I was a wounded animal. And what he said, and he really said it so nicely. He said, you're not leaving this industry. Like he was like hurt that I was leaving this industry. And that, yeah, he hauled me from that first sentence. I'm in, whatever you propose. And
let's do it. Nice.
Wow. And what year?
Again, short version.
What year did you join Reyes?
So that conversation happened in 2012. So okay. That's how long I wrote the 2008 crisis.
Okay. No, yeah. So, yeah, because I wasn't sure when you had joined, if it was around the time of the rebranding. So you were there before the rebranding,
that,
for sure.
No, yeah. The rebranding to De Los Reyes was done in 2015.
Right.
But this was the retooling, which was a long process.
Right.
So I mean, basically years before and 4 years, and the reason I got a phone call of Augusto Reyes is because I was a customer there. I was making cigars there. you know, project. There's always something coming, somebody right. exports some micro brands, house brands. I mean, there's always something to do. What he called me for was the project. Nirka was getting back. That was the project. She was actually getting back and learning all the things. And the project was to change De Los Reyes factory of what it had become. In the year before that, we were doing a lot, say, catalog business. Mm-hmm. Was a lot of cigars produced. The key word was speed, numbers. It was definitely not quality. And basically, I think the Reyes went just about it out of wanting to ruin their soul. Wanted to do cigars like they always did all their lives. And we retooled. I mean, that was Nirka's project. And that's why really Nirka came in back in, was to redo the factory so that we do things we enjoy more, we're definitely proud of, we'll defend everywhere, and we'll enjoy every day. And that's what we've been doing. But this has, it has taken time. I mean, the catalogs we were doing, they were partners, they were friends of them. And you know, you cannot break a contract like that and that's it. You have to, you know, ease up into it. And it happened. And we downgraded. We were left with a lot less rollers. I mean, you've seen the factory, Will. It's a cozy factory. We wanted to keep. Not the others, and you have employees there who have been there for 20 years, 30 years. There's all kind of, but I mean, it's really a family, and that's one of the really really great things about the De Los Reyes. I believe it represents an image of a cigar manufacturer, which is a serious manufacturer. It's not an operation in the back of a house. You've seen the factory; it's a real factory, but it's really familial. It's really the tradition of what tobacco and cigars are, which to me is very important, because one makes an idea of what cigars are, and then you see it. I mean, when it's too much of a factory, to me, it kills a little bit the buzz, the fun that I have every day with.
You know, we, right after I got back from Pro Cigar, Aaron and I had Charlie Minato on, and we were talking about Pro Cigar, because that was my first Pro Cigar, and he was on a lot of the Pro Cigars. And he came out, you know, he asked me, he said, what tours did you go on? And I mentioned I was on the De Los Reyes tour. And he spoke very highly. He says, isn't that one of the better tours like you've been on? I'm like, yeah, it was very, the whole thing from start to finish was very unique. And I think the way you guys went through it, starting with the farm and then going into that factory, which there was something about that factory, Jean-Michel, that I hadn't seen in any other factory. I don't know if it was the way it was, you know, it had a cozy feel, what you said. But you also got that this is a pretty serious factory that you have going on here as well.
It's a real factory. And of course, we do have an in-house Belgian, which is essential to a good cigar factory.
Yeah.
Something, I don't know what the others are doing, but we do. Yeah. But no, there is something about the size we have. It's, I mean, you know, bigger factories are just bigger, and maybe we could be jealous of it or whatever, but it's, you know, every size for everything, and I'm not trying to, you know, size matters, it's not a conversation, right. But every size gets its advantages and its disadvantages. We are very serious. We're very serious about tobacco. It starts with tobacco. We're very serious, or we measure things. We're very serious of comps.
You lost him.
We may have that DR, the gerbil in the DR.
Is he protesting?
Constantly changing the way we work, constantly. The way you keep the passion going in a family, I believe it's important. You know, there was a time for tradition. No, we are in reinventing within the traditional way. So leaving respect. I mean, just this afternoon, there's a guy there who's in charge of our production. His name is Roberto. And I was looking at him through the window, through an office. You know, there is a window. And the guy was just lost in his head looking at tobacco. And I think, I mean, you know, I'm a lousy photographer, but I wish to keep those images in mind, because that's what we do. We touch things, we feel things, and when we do a cigar, there is no marketing pressure for us to take out the cigars or not. The packaging is not done, even though we have very nice packaging. It's not done before the cigars is made up, where we have the idea. We really do this because that's what we like. And of course, I mean, taste and colors, maybe not everybody follows or of products, but I believe we have so many different products, because one thing was just really, really great at the De Los Reyes factories, because of the size of the family group in tobacco, which is a little bit larger than the factory itself, we have access to a lot of tobaccos that normally you have to be really big. And then when you're that big, you cannot really use those funny tobaccos, because you just don't get enough of them. Yeah. So it's we have this facility to be able to play with tobacco and everything, which, I mean, really, I don't want to do anything else. It took me a couple of years, and I just mentioned I went through aviation, hotel business, whatever stuff, and this is what I like to do. This is what I don't want to hand to it. And I mean,
no, it's beautiful to hear that. Going back a little, like the Reyes family, they have six generations, over 160 years. What was their background? They were more growers, correct, as they started out?
Well, cigars really in the Dominican Republic is a newer thing. I mean, we did tobacco for a long time, and the Reyes did tobacco. And there is at least one family I know in the DR which can find ancestor doing tobacco since longer than the Reyes, but none of them did it in an interrupted way. There was always somebody during old generations doing tobacco. Well, family I have in mind right now had interruptions. But tobacco was done in the DR. It's the poor work we did at that time brought us the facilities we have, because it was exported at the beginning of the century to Germany, to Holland, and basically tobacco was not fermented, was really poorly treated. And because of Germany and Holland wanted to improve the quality of what they were receiving, they send us people to check. You know, some of the famous names are the Kellner, the Windbell, whatever. There was a lot of names of people who just came to make, standards in the tobacco, and that helped us a whole lot. But to really make cigars, you have to wait, even though there was people making cigars. I mean, La Aurora had a factory in 1903, but it was not really a huge business. That's a little things. People in Dominican Republic were smoking what we call pachuches. You know, we call the pachuche the roll-up of one leaf. Mm-hmm. We do try a tobacco when we buy from the bale, but basically that man, I take a leaf of tobacco, I roll a small cigars, and I light it up, and that's it. That was the cigar conception. Then we had the andullo, which is a whole other thing from the south of the Dominican Republic, which actually played a lot of historic role in the Dominican Republic, and it's basically a maceration of tobacco. Some even prepare it by putting it into earth, but at least pressing it very hard with special mixtures in it. And that's been around for 200 years. But cigars really come to the Dominican Republic in the 70s, and we had people like Manolo Quesada, who were really essential, Don Fernando León, there was a time where there were really four horsemen of tobacco in the DR doing cigars, but it was a lot of people. And the Reyes started with the Piloto Cubano in the 60s. I believe you saw it well, that in our wall in Navarrete, it's written that this was the spot for the first Piloto Cubano crop in the DR, which changed a whole lot. Because before the endemic tobacco species, first of all, there was not that many variety, the standards were not fixed. So you had all of different tobaccos, and quite frankly, the interest was not there to make it a good quality tobacco. But you know, that this is before the 60s, so it's far away.
Right.
We have improved things.
Yeah. You know, never already. That was a really interesting, that farm was just interesting from top to bottom, that farm. It's kind of in the middle of a city in a little bit. You know, it's not in the middle of nowhere. And it's kind of an old school factory. The way Leo runs that factory, it's like old school. He uses a lot of old school techniques, and I was blown away what I was seeing there.
It's not a factory. It's a tobacco processing.
I'm sorry. I meant farm. I meant farm. I'm getting old.
It was in the middle of nowhere. The city grew around.
They built the city around it. Yeah.
Exactly. You fly in Santiago, three times over four times you fly in Santiago, you will fly over Navarrete. And you will see all those because we have all the shades,
right?
The sun shades go down and it looks like a city covered in the middle. But those are the fields right in the middle of the city. Probably it's worth a lot more in real estate.
Yeah.
To make developments. But again, there is something about tradition. No, I like to say this a whole lot, and it's completely made up. It's not true etymologically, it's a joke, but I like to say that passion, it's an English word, what actually can be translated with the same sounds, which is really, really close of the Italian word of pazzo, to be a little nut, to be that passionate.
Yeah.
There is no etymology there, but I really believe there is a relation in between the passion we have for tobacco and pazzo from Italy.
Yeah. And you know, there's some tobaccos that the Reyes family grows that are kind of unique tobaccos. Two that come to mind that have kind of been getting more popular, and I'm pretty sure most of it comes from the Reyes farms, are Negrito and Carbonel.
Well, the Negrito was definitely put together. I have to say the truth, there is other people now growing Negrito because, yeah, this is not Monsanto's world and the seeds, you can keep them a little bit and people right. do their own thing. So there are other Negritos there, but Negrito was developed by Los Reyes. And there are things, I believe, when you came this year, we showed you a failed crop.
Yeah.
We showed you a failed crop because... Yeah, not everything is showing. I mean, there were plants. You've seen right. the plants and everything, but we showed you a few crops because when you believe that passionately in tobacco, and the crop you've seen was from the original Corojo. And the original Corojo is a very, very, very sensitive plant. And the blue mole, the mojo azul, we got attacked.
Yeah.
And Leo really bends backwards to use ways where, I mean, I don't want to use organic, but some of it is, and methods to avoid using chemicals when not necessary. It's not that we're against it that way, but we try to do things a little bit more when there were no chemicals. Well, you've seen that we plant corn along the yep. along the field for the insects who actually attack the corn are actually attacked. The insects who attack tobacco. So, you know, this kind of things we do constantly. And so we lost a lot of the crop. And when this starts, I mean, you can only save a few plants and you have to, first of all, let them bloom in the middle of the sequence and hoping that one will not be attacked. And but we save a portion of it and you will see it in the short tail. But it's something who happens. And we thought, you know what? Everybody who visits factories and fields, because we do the field and factory, they've seen fields. They're going to see fields tomorrow and see things were organized and engineers and everything. Let's show what happens.
This, yeah.
There was a lot of money lost right in front of your eyes. A lot of money lost. But this is, and this won't deter. We're doing it again. I mean, not everything is lost. We're not, but there's a lot of loss, and there are safer ways to grow tobacco. But that's what definitely Leo likes to do. If I always say that if Leo spoke English, everybody would know his name.
No, you guys had this nailed down. You had the microphones out there, the wire, the speakers. So they're moving speakers, Aaron, around the farm, which to make sure everyone can hear. I don't know that was logistically you guys pulled it off real well. I got to say that.
Well, again, we all believe in it. We try to do this in many languages. I carry the speaker.
Yeah.
I carry the speaker. We try because if there are questions, this is the moment. I mean, people who attend the Food Cigar Festival are apasionados. They come there. They like to talk with us, but they like to learn a little bit. And sometimes learning, it's not about being academic. It's this weird question I always ask, and let me ask it. And this is the occasion where you actually get it from the horse's mouth, from the people who grow it, from the people who are really there. I mean, we try to do our best to get an answer to everything because we believe people do the effort to come and visit us. They deserve it. And I mean this. I know it sounds a little corny, but I really mean it.
No, and one of the things I took back from Pro Cigar, and I was telling everyone how great it was there's a whole part of the business that we got to interact with that you normally don't get to interact with stateside. So it's, you know, more people on the agricultural and the production end, which it's just a very different model than like going to one of the festivals where you're interacting with your brand representatives, and nothing wrong with that, but it's just a different group of people you're interacting with. And that was my big takeaway at a Pro Cigar.
Well, I mean, it's, you know, there is even people who leave home saying that they're going to work at Pro Cigar. I mean, some journalists are, but really it's a real party. It's a real party. That's what we do. It's a celebration. It's the biggest celebration you can have about a passion. I mean, I'm guessing that's what folks must feel when they go to Comic Con and they spend all of their life dressed like that. I mean, if you're passionate about cigars, this is the place to be. I mean, it's safe. I don't think you felt unsafe, even in the middle of protests. It's safe. It's technologically there. Everybody has Wi-Fi and data and everything. And those are great parties. I think they're done with a lot of taste. And you get to smoke a whole lot and to see the real people. The people who do it. I mean, on the daytime, you will see the guys who are sitting there doing it all the time. And in the parties, I mean... Yeah. They'll be there better dressed.
Very true. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, the White Knight is something special, obviously, as well. I was, like I said, I was exhausted. You guys were one of the last ones to leave. I'm exhausted, right? and these guys, like Jean-Michel's going strong. And then we went to wait to get the car, and I got the second wind, right? So then I went back to the Debonair house, and I ended up staying up another 2 hours smoking after that because I got the second wind. So. But it was good. It was good there. So
that's how we live. Second win to second win.
So going back to 2015, that's when the rebrand happens. The company's rebranded as De Los Reyes Cigars, new logo, and new brands start getting launched. And that's around. And Nurka's already in charge of the company at that point. So Nurka's running the company. Leo runs the farms. Who runs the factory?
Oh, okay. The Nirke is running the company. I mean, that makes you the manager of the factory.
Right. Okay.
Definitely takes care more of the administrative than on the day-to-day rolling.
Right.
Well, presently, I've been a lot more involved in the things of the factory because, you know, I'm grounded, cannot go and visit.
Yep.
So, you know, one thing was beautiful in this industry is that we learn, all of us, no matter who, all the time. Look, to me, maybe I have a little bit more to learn, but again, it's been a couple of decades. Like some things have stuck a little bit. And right now at the factory, Nirka and I are handling the whole factory thing. Everything. One thing I like to say though, you said that the company was rebranded and it's true that the logo was right, but this is important because the idea of tradition, you know, there is a brand for everything.
Right.
Brand who go more modern and colors and everything. De Los Reyes was the original name of the company. Started by Augusto Reyes. So we got back to De Los Reyes. Actually, you'll be amazed, you know, the legal stamp, the rubber stamp we have to put on documents. Now we're changing it to the new logo. We've been using the one from the 80s, literally.
Oh, really?
Literally. It's the same thing and everything because that was the one who was registered to the Dominican Chamber of Commerce. That's kind of funny, but it's going back to the root. I mean, Corporación Cigar Export CC was actually one of the companies Augusto Reyes purchased during the things, and it had the documents for exports and everything. It was easy to use that one, and that's how it became Corporación Cigar Export. And what was done by Nirka, and it's important to her as well, is go back to the roots. Come back and call it De Los Reyes Cigars again, because it's about the Reyes surname.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Very good. It's very good. And you, the first major brand that's under this, when you went back to De Los Reyes, is the Saga brand. That's your bread.
Actually, Oh, the SAG actually started way before. I mean, we actually did the Don Julio in 2013 because that was the project. Mm-hmm. So I came in when the project was half done, the Don Julio. Don Julio Reyes is a great, it's Nirka's great-grandfather. He was essential to trying to introduce different seeds into the DR and grow them up. So I'm guessing the whole world of smokers, including the world who came after in Nicaragua and everything, hold him some kind of gratitude, because that's let's try to mess up a little bit with seeds in different right. soils. So that cigar was done for him. He lived to be 94 years old, so Nirka knew him. It's not a picture on the wall. It's somebody they were interactions with. And this was really an homage cigar. And that's the reason we have kinds of rules. We don't want to look fancy, but we don't want the cigars to be undersold or badly placed or people tearing up the lids in the shops and everything. If the place doesn't respect the Don Julio, I have in the past, and I will retain the names of the shop, just bought the box bags. And we don't come in with baseball bats. We just buy the boxes, you know, and just take them away. And that's it, because this is not a place for Don Julio. And that was the first cigar. The Saga came in 2014, so before it came back to De Los Reyes, but it was already the whole idea initiated in 2011. This is a slow process, gents. It's not a corporate decision, and that's right. it. And everything has to be thought of, because we can't.
And the Don Julio was an all Dominican cigar, if I'm remembering, and that did use a Dominican wrapper. So I mean,
all the tobaccos from the Don Julio were grown by Leo. All of them, wrapper, binder, the three ligeros in there, and because yes, there are three ligeros. Basically, the concept of the Don Julio was to take rich Cuban seed tobaccos in well fertile soils of the DR, and take strong tobacco. When you look at the wrapper, it looks like leather. When you look, basically, when a cigar age, it's generally accepted. I don't think none of my colleagues will go against this. Generally accepted that it's a trade-off in between power and probably strength, and little by little you gain sophistication. Let's put it this way: it's a trade-off around the years till maybe you get too far. But we decided to do exactly that. Let's take tobaccos of very good quality, but with a lot of body, and just let them age into being a less strong cigar, but a very rich cigar. So that's what we have with Don Julio. The cigar is not really strong. It's only Dominican tobacco. It's only grown by Leo. And it's more of a medium profile probably, but it's so rich because of those tobaccos originally being so strong.
And I've smoked it. In fact, Phil Zenge gave me my first Don Julio, I remember. And this is before I met you. And it's a very complex cigar as well. I mean, so the flavor is just a lot going on with that cigar. It's a special cigar. I think that's, you know, and you guys, it's a limited cigar, right? So you don't make a lot of them, and it's only available to certain retailers, correct?
It's, yes, we're a little peculiar. We don't really push it anywhere. Where it's limited means that it hams, and the idea is not having it in hand at all. But probably if we were faced with world success of that cigar, it will run out because we can only have so many after that much aging. And then there are certainly in certain markets, it cannot carry you've seen the boxes, there is tobacco inside the box. Mm-hmm. That tobacco is pressed. It's not loose tobacco hanging around. It's a box of tobacco within the box. And that tobacco needs special care. You don't close to ferment it and definitely age it. Well, your risk is alpha fermentation. In the best cases, your cigar is going to have different colors on the sides and everything. So doing that box of tobacco, which is basically growing fresh tobacco, so that it doesn't fly away, that it's really a box of tobacco. It's a lot of work. And just because that's the product. And if it is a lot of work, it's a lot of work. That's the product. That's the way it has to go out. And again, making millions of those, just the facilities would be among us, because you have to keep them as cigars, but those are cigars which are huge boxes. Those boxes of tobacco. So just aging them, it would be like something that you've seen our facilities. It doesn't mean, so the numbers are probably limited, but not like a limited series or anything. This right. is something. This is an homage we're trying to maintain, a tribute that we'll try to maintain for as right. long as possible.
Right. Now, with the Saga line, that was more. What was the vision behind the Saga line?
Well, I mean, the whole idea at this time, because of what happened and the catalogs and the brands that were existed in the past, having lost a little bit of their shine, we were looking for first of all, we had the first cigars of Sagas were the blend number 7 and the Golden Age, which right. is the original seed of Piloto Cubano, which we're the only ones who actually grow. And we wanted something to tell the whole story. And Saga is this Nahua word, which means a tale, a legend, which normally in Vikings were told from generation to generation. And it entices a lot of things. The stories of a little village somewhere, the invasion of a whole continent. It entices a lot of things. And through times and territories. And we thought it was really cool to be able to call our saga, this saga, your saga, make your own saga. It's really a name that we clicked immediately. Certainly Nirka did. Augusto Reyes, her father, was actually not really a fan because there is in the Cibao Central, in the center of the Dominican Republic, when a baseball player didn't have a good day, you know, missed a couple of occasions to shoot it and stuff like that, we say it's a saguita, you know, it's a saga. It's the word who's used. I remember going to his office with Nirka to convince him that probably most of our public is not going to be baseball fans in the Cibao Central, which is very, very specific way of knowing that word. And that saga in the whole world. And then it had the added advantage that you can say saga in every language around the planet.
Yeah. Yeah, it really
there is a lot of words were typically Spanish. And this is saga, it goes well in every language.
That's true. And so, I see, yeah, go ahead.
No. So that was basically the old idea. We had a concept and wanted to make different cigars because you know we manufacture a couple of cigars. We manufacture Phil Zanghi's Debonair and Indian motorcycle line, and brands like Maduro and old Casa de Sueños or our new friends. We manufacture cigars for other people. So the easiest thing that falls upon a factory who's actually doing cigars for other people is that you're a one-trick pony. We're doing one blend with different bands and different wrappers. And that is something that we would have felt terribly sad if it was to be true in any one of our cigars. And we made sure that it doesn't happen because we believe that really tobacco is so extended the world today in this day and age that we can make very, very different tobacco without ever, ever having the same taste profile and everything. When you carry all the sagas, you really have very different cigars. You have cigars. I mean, the one you're smoking right now, you close your eyes and you try to recognize that one versus a Golden Age. And that one has Piloto Cubano. And no, it could come from another world.
Yeah.
It could come from another world. Both worlds are really good.
Yeah.
But it could come from another world.
Yeah, no, I see you're smoking the Saga number 7 right now in the Perfecto, if I'm not mistaken.
It is definitely a Perfecto.
Yeah,
I love the blend number 7. I believe probably the most underrated cigars we have, because there is no reason to underrate it. First of all, it's a great cigar, but probably it's the cheaper one. And probably that deters people, but that Perfecto, it's beautiful. It is really beautiful. It's a cigar that's easy to smoke, but really, really, really clean. And it would really brings a different array of flavors in the Cuban traditional style, but yet mixing it with more, I don't want to go as far to say it's the IPA of cigars because that's not true, but there is though a little citrus going on and things were a little bit more modern in a Cuban classical way. And it's a very clean cigar, very easy to smoke, and yet very entertaining because so many varieties of flavors when you smoke it.
Yeah.
So I'm enjoying the Blend 7 a whole lot. And quite frankly, I'm asked a whole lot, you know, what was your best cigar experience? And I had lots of answers for this, and some were kind of made up, you know, I'm part of the show. But honestly, the best cigar I can now remember for years in my head was after the opening gala of a pro cigar 4 years ago. And I was really tired. I had smoked my day all day long, but this was the first night, so I would go back to Puerto Rico and then go back to Santiago the next day to stay for the duration of pro cigar. And quite frankly, I lit that blend number 7 in my car to keep me awake. I'm not going to lie to you. The whole idea was to keep me awake. I needed not to die that night. That was my mission. I take my mission seriously.
Right.
And when I got home, knowing that I really, if everything goes well, I have 3 hours to sleep, that cigar was so good that I stayed outside and smoked my cigars till the very end, because it's like I had smoked hundreds of Blend 7s with that one, but that one was so good that I needed to enjoy it to the last, and I really wanted the moment to last all night. I would have loved to see the sunrise with that cigar, but I went to bed as soon as it was over.
Well, that's what I was doing back at the house there. I was like, it was tempting to kind of just smoke all night, which I've been known to do, but I knew we had long days. I had to force myself to go to sleep.
Those are long days.
Yeah. But what I like about the number 7, too, and I do believe that is the most underrated cigar you have a cigar that it's affordable in a perfecto size, right? You can have an everyday perfecto cigar with the Saga Blend number 7. And there's not a lot of lines I can say that about.
Every time we present a cigar, and this is one of the things we like to say, how much do you think this cigar cost? And this sentence is true in Slovakia, in Singapore, in Germany, in Georgia, in California. How much do you think this cigar cost? And people are always blown away. When they're smoking, they're blown away. Really? That's a price? So probably I should spend more time in shops.
Yep. So you guys build on that. And then the year after you launch the Short Tail series. And it's a series of 10 installments, right? And right now there are 6 of them, I'd say, popular in the market, right? But there's 10 of them, right? You guys have some more of them. I know that. I remember you come out with the first one, and I remember this, you were telling me about it. And then people coming back from Pro Cigar, I think had tried that first, the Tales of High Priming cigar. And they're like, you got to smoke this. People tell me, Coop, you got to smoke this cigar. And I remember finally when I got my hands on that cigar, like that was just, I never expected a cigar from you guys to come out. That was a powerhouse of a cigar, but it was loaded with flavor. But that cigar was as strong as any cigar I had when I started smoking that.
It was the idea from this first tale from the saga, because that's the whole idea, the short tales of the saga, which is telling little stories. Every book of the series is a size, a different taste profile, different blend completely. The volume one, the tomo uno in Spanish, it was a little bit the idea. When we were already a little tired traveling around the United States, everybody said, well, I want strong cigars. I'm smoking strong cigars. And we were under the impression, for what we understand in tobacco, that lots of cigars were strong out there. Were there because of some unprocessed tobacco purposely to make it strong, to make it something that... And that's not the way we believe a good cigar should always improve with age. And probably when you use unprocessed tobacco, partly unprocessed tobacco, not everything, we'll lose that strength over time. So we wanted to make our own strong tobacco. Tobacco, which is tobacco, and it will lose something over age when you age it, but you can smoke. I have 100 cigars from the first batch of that, and I'm trying to keep them as long as I can. I hope I still hold on for many years, because I really want to do that. This is a cigar which we make with what we understand we can do with tobacco. And there is a lot of different tobaccos in there. It's not Dominican tobacco per se. Of course, Dominican tobacco, of course, from our farms, but you have tobacco from Nicaragua, from North America. You have all kinds of tobacco there to make what we believe this is truly good, processed, strong tobacco. And people sometimes ask, why is it so short? Sometimes we try to make it a little longer. Nobody could smoke it. You can see the smoke. I mean, you guys know Phil. You know he can smoke basically, I do, from the smoke, the muffler of a car. And the first time he tried a cigar, he basically sneaks those cigars. He steals them from my desk like all the time. He loves those cigars. He sneaked a cigar like that, and we're going to the back of the factory at the end of the things. And he had to sit down, and he looked at me like, I don't understand. How is this possible?
Yeah.
It was not aged yet, so it was really, really, really strong as a cigar. To have the big mighty Phil Zanghi sit down, it was something. It was made as a strong cigar, but notice, it's not a strong cigar who burns like this. It's a very slow burner.
Yeah, I was going to say that, yes.
When we really believe the way we, again, our version of what we understand and we like to offer is that the strength of a tobacco of a cigar is not there to prove who's the man and who can smoke more than the other, and not at all. The strength of a tobacco is there to allow oneself to balance himself like easier. When I don't know if I said that right, you know my English, but it's really meant for you not to have to count to 45 till the next puff so that the cigar doesn't cool off. That's basically the concept. You choose, your brain chooses a cigar, you know, which has this strength profile to counterbalance yourself without having you to think too much about it, because it takes off of the pleasure away. And that cigar is really meant to be smoked really, really slowly. In fact, and I've seen this, it's one of my favorite first cigars of the day. No, that doesn't make the monster who smoked from the muffler of a big Jeep. No, not at all. It's that when I choose a short tail number one as a first cigar of the day, I'll smoke it 2.5-3 hours. Because you're going to puff a lot less to it.
Yeah. I was going to say the same thing. I tend to smoke those slow, and I don't feel like it's a shorter smoke, but I don't think it's one of those cigars you're going to smoke in a half hour. And nor do you want to try. If you try to smoke in a half hour, not only is it going to be overpowering, you're not going to get what that cigar is going to deliver.
No, and the tobacco helps it. It's a slow burn. It's something you can leave 5 minutes in the ashtray and pick it up and don't reach out for your lighter. You don't need it. It's there. It's doing its thing. It's not burning. It has its internal combustion like tobacco is supposed to do. And that's how you really get all the taste and all the flavors. And when getting certainly in the second third of the short tail number one, you really get a lot of flavors you didn't expect to be there in that kind of cigar.
Yeah.
That's what I enjoy about it.
No, I agree. And then you go with Tomo 2, The Tales of the Land, and you have a very unique wrapper on that cigar.
Well, that wrapper, and it's exceptional because, to my knowledge, it's the only wrapper developed by a woman in this business.
Yeah.
I'm sure it will change in the future. But Monica Kellner, she's the daughter of Enki Kellner, you know, the guru of tobacco. But she's married to Nika's father.
Yes.
So it's somebody we really deal with. And again, the family thing going on. And she developed the tobacco. And I have to confess, and I told her this, so I don't need to say it in public. When I was told, Monica has a rapper and we should, look into it and everything, I felt, you know, like this is going to be a little bit like forced on us and everything. And I was so happy. That's the truth. I mean, let's see it. When I tried that wrapper, and I tried it, I made a pachuche, there was no filler in there and everything. That wrapper was so special, so flavorful, so enticing, the whole palate. I was so happy, actually, that this was the case. This was really not forced on us. We loved that wrapper from the moment we saw it, and we definitely, the moment, tried it. And that's what's really special about the short tail number two, The Tales of the Land Cotuí. And Cotuí is the area where it comes from, which is not an area known for tobacco in the DR. But it should and it will, because it's a very rich area. It's the only place where we have a few we call them rivers. In North America, there are little rivers, but we call them rivers, you know, and they come from the mountains, and normally rivers go straight to the sea. This is the only place in the DR where they really go through the valley. That valley is so rich. Everything was brought from those two chains of mountains, both north and central, goes to that valley. So I believe the expression is you throw a nickel and you get a copper tree. That's exactly what happens in that valley. So the tobacco is different. Even if you plant a regular seed in that valley, and Cotuí, by the way, is the main town place who's been known for the Davidoff cigar, Yamata, because it's right there. It's on the top of it. It's the Sierra de Yamata. The name of the last mountains of the northern chain falls into Cotuí.
Okay.
It's not the same soil, though. It's completely not the same soil. If you go to Yamasa, you'll see reddish soil. And the ground in Cotuí, it's not as dark as in volcanic places like Nicaragua, but it's a darker brown. It's a completely different color. More chocolate.
Okay. Is that wrapper exclusively for De Los Reyes? Because I don't think I've seen a
generally, yes. Practically, there is another gentleman which is the brother of Monica. His name is Hendrik Kellner. He's the son of Hendrik Kellner. And he has used it in a couple of cigars. You won't see it in a lot. I mean, first of all, the Kellner Boutique Factory, which is a company, is a very small factory. So you won't see a lot of cigars anywhere, no matter what. But he's been using it exclusively and notoriously on the Enke, which is a limited edition that Enki Kellner took out.
I like that cigar. I didn't realize it was. I like that cigar a lot.
Completely different application, which proved that, again, there is no limit.
Yeah.
Same wrapper, but completely different application, completely different taste for those who have tried it.
That's great. Then is the Tomo 3, 4, and 5. They're some of the smaller cigars that you have. But what I liked, and I have the Tomo 3 here. You mentioned the Piloto Cubano, right? And those cigars, from what I understand, they're all based on Piloto Cubano and the filler, and they all use San Vicente binders on them. But they're all very different cigars in their own right.
Yes, they are. Well, that was the whole idea. Like, you know, we're talking about the saga. We have those books, old-fashioned looking. So let's use the word declension. I love to say that we make a declension of the Piloto Cubano with those three cigars. Basically, the idea was the same binder, 50% of Piloto Cubano. And then number three there as a wrapper, which is a filler. The other 50% of the filler, besides the Piloto Cubano, is from Brazil. It's Habano seed from Brazil. It's the famous Cubra. Mm-hmm. And the wrapper is from Ecuador. It's a very special cigar because it's a very small cigar, but it gives abundant volumes of smoke for the size. Mm-hmm. And it has this traditional taste going on, but there is something going on to that cigar, which is completely different than the two others, yet 50% is the same Piloto Cubano. But it's a great, this is a shorter smoke. It's a short tail. It's a shorter smoke, but it's still a real cigar. This is not a 20-minute cigar.
No.
It will keep you busy over half an hour. And again, this is good quality cigar. It's a cigar it's definitely not something you smoke at a short buzz, but we thought, because it's very brave to make smoker cigars in our day and age, because people expect them to be so much cheaper than bigger cigars. Well, basically, they're the same word and cost and everything, so they're a little bit cheaper. But it's complicated to dare to do that. And we wanted to do it with the volume 3, the volume 4, and the volume 5, which, by the way, have pompous Latin name, which acronyms are live, love, laugh, which is important. The declension. That's a declension, and they stand for labor ipse voluptas, which is the hard work is the pleasure itself. And then there's a story inside the book about the pleasure we take about dealing with tobacco. But that is a neat little cigar. The other one, the number four, which is the love for labor omnia vincit, hard work always prevail. It's a completely different cigar. First, it has a little perfecto size, a little bit figurado size, but on micro. And this is a size that Mr. Reyes himself, when he did the Augusto Reyes coffee break, and in the factory, this is the way we call it. You know, you can have a Augusto, whatever we call it, coffee break mold. That's a coffee break mold. And what better? It's a coffee break mold. And what we did with that, it's an Ecuador Sumatra on the wrapper. But I believe it's the only example, I think, where Pennsylvania has been blended like that with Piloto Cubano 50-50 gifts. The traditional sweet and a little bite, which keeps you really occupied. It's a great coffee break cigar, whether it's a tall one in a plastic cup or a small one in an espresso cup. And then we have the Lef, which is a completely different cigar. By the way, Laudamus Abundancia Veteres, which means we praise, we respect, we love the influence of the past, or the elders, of the things of the past. And the story is all about, in the past, people smoked smaller cigars before we went to bigger cigars.
Right.
But this is a panetela. It's a panetela with an Ecuador Claro, an Ecuador Connecticut, but that's getting politically difficult. An Ecuador Claro, and when you see a panetela with a Claro wrapper, you're thinking of a drier taste, something more in the lines of Macanudos and Davidoff's, a drier taste, something will burn in a dry way, really, a little bit creamy, a little bit bright. And what we did there with the Piloto Cubano is we blended with a broadleaf Connecticut. And that gives a completely different panetella. It burns in a plumier way. The volume of the contact, the weight of the smoke, much like wine, is completely different on your tongue.
Right.
And that completed our declension of the Piloto Cubano in those three cigars. The Leaf Lofra.
Right. Yeah, like I said, I love that little four. That little perfecto is a great little size. Again, a very unique, kind of a unique size. You don't see that, something like that, a lot. And it's a, you know, it's like I said, it's a cigar. It's not a, it's small, but it's a cigar. And it, like I said, I get a nice experience out of that as well.
Again, there are smaller, but those are cigars.
Yeah.
It's not the old idea. It's not to have a short, fat cigar, but it's a real cigar. It has a 44 ring gauge. The number four.
Yeah. No, I agree. Totally.
And I'm old enough to remember when 44 was the norm, and when the ring gauge came, everybody said that will never last, and they were right. It went to 60 before we knew it.
But
the old idea, I think, at that time was to go back to 44.
Right. Then you come to you know, the one that's the one spectacular cigar. It was my number one cigar last year. I don't want to speak for Aaron. You had that pretty highly rated, I think, as well. The Tomo 6.
Yes.
Well, we're gonna talk about that. But what was nice about Jean-Michel? I saw everyone smoking the Tomo 6s in the factory when I was there. I was like, okay, they really like this cigar too. You guys do a Maduro. You knock it. This thing got knocked out of the park. This was, and you talk about a cigar that ages well. This cigar ages very, very well. And like I said, I think it's a total masterpiece in my mind. I love that cigar.
Well, you honored us by giving us, the best recommendation of the year with the cigar of the year 2019. But I believe, yes, it ages well, and so should every cigar. This is like pizza. You know, the test for pizza is, you can eat it cold, it's a good pizza.
Right.
Well, a cigar should age well.
Right.
If not, there is something wrong at the base with that cigar. I mean, a cigar should age well. But that cigar was really made as, I mean, Nirka came up with that in the middle of an interview, actually. And she said that after describing technically the flavors and whatever, so she looked at the camera and said, well, I believe the technical word is yummy. And I could have coined it better. I think nobody could have coined it better. That's the way it works. And so definitely it's a cigar, it's a treat. It's really a treat. It's like having dessert at any given moment. And you can have dessert in the morning. I mean, no problem with that. It has all the different sweets we do in the tobacco world right there, and they really combine well. You know, when you blend things, sometimes they complement themselves. But here it's really a case, it's like a pairing of tobacco where it really creates a third dimension.
Yeah.
It gives you really with a complete different impression of the palate when you're done with that cigar. It really had something. And we were, it's a very, very difficult wrapper it just right, because that wrapper is not painted, it's whatever, it's dark, and it's dark through the moment it's fermented in a way, and if you burn it or if you handle it too much, you may destroy it and everything. It's a very, very difficult wrapper to get right, but we're quite happy with the results, and definitely gives. It's as I say, it's really an array of all the sweets we know in tobacco, from the Cuban traditionals in North America, the San Andres, which time a couple of years ago was hidden by everybody. Nobody wanted to feel the San Andres, and definitely why? Because it complements stays in a phenomenal way. I believe the market has found that as well, not just us.
Yeah, and what I liked about the way it complemented it was, and I've been like, a lot of San Andreas wrappers can sometimes overpower the blends for me, and it didn't do that with this cigar. It really kind of, like I said, it just enhanced everything else with this cigar. You know, it's a bigger ring gauge, and I think it works perfect with this bigger ring gauge. I think this is the size you wanted for this, and you know, I think that's what I've liked about the Short Tail series, is that you seem like you nailed the sizes with each of these for the blends. And I think that's something that's really, really I appreciate from those cigars.
Well, thank you for that. But it's true. And it does create another dimension to the research when we're doing the blends and everything. And quite frankly, the final result of that blend number six, if we were the Short Tail number six, the Short Tail number six, we could never have made a Lancero out of it, because there are just too many different tobaccos in there. Right. It would never have fit. But to get the size just right, and not too long and not too small, and it'll keep, it's actually something we research till we have the cigar, and then we think of the package. That's definitely like that.
I agree. And this was a little longer for a Short Tail. It was a 5.5 inches. So it was a little longer, but I liked it too, because you get plenty of smoke with it. You know, you get plenty of time to smoke it, which is nice. You can really enjoy it.
I'm going to go ahead and break them all and tell you that in the future, there'll be a Lancero in those books.
Oh, nice.
Oh, really?
Not immediately. In the future, there'll be a Lancero. Right now, the next one, I'm going to break them all as well. It's a malt press. It's a square cigar.
Mm. Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Again, different blends, different habits. That's what we want to do with the Short Tail. It's something, of course, I mean, as a you know, like the commercials about the air thing, it's like, I'm not only the president, I'm also a customer.
Yeah.
I collect stuff from Tabacchione all the way. And I know that if I had seen those books anywhere, I needed them all, no matter what was it. I know that.
Yeah.
But the whole idea is to take people through different journeys and effectively and reaffirm, because there is a moment for different cigars. What's your favorite cigar? Well, it depends. First of all, I like to state officially that I believe that every honest answer to a question regarding tobacco should be answered starting by "it depends." Mm-hmm. Every single one of them.
Yeah.
There's no way to really affirm something in tobacco. Yes. But I believe that there is a moment for everything, and there is a moment you feel like this cigar, and there's a moment, and that's a great answer, the Saga Short Tails. There's really a moment for every one of them.
Yep.
And I don't cease to rotate through them.
Yep. And I gotta admit, there's times I don't get too involved with the story behind the cigar, but with those Short Tails, I did, right? I really got involved with, like, I loved how the packaging was done. I liked the little story that was in each of those, like a little book. I thought they were well written. They were great. And it to me, that actually enhanced the experience even more. And that normally doesn't, I normally don't have that effect. Bear, who's the other person we work with, he tends to get more into that than I do. But with the Short Tails, I absolutely was getting into, you know, you know, and I'll pick, you know, when I smoke them up, sometimes I'll pick the book up and I'll just kind of read it again. It's kind of a really cool thing. So I love
you're the person who wrote the book. You're the one guy who actually read the book.
Well, I read it.
We were joking and saying that we were going to put little sentences in the middle just to see.
I'll catch it. No, they were great. They're just great. And I have them on the book. I have them in my office. They're in my the empty boxes are in my bookshelf. So, you know, so
you know, they say when you take a book, it's about, you know, versus certainly an e-reader or something like that. There's something about the contact, the paper, the smell. There is something about it. That's generally what people say about books, and. This is the whole thing, because with a cigar, it's the same thing. The first thing you do when you pick up a cigar is you embrace it. You say hello to it. You pulp it a little bit. You touch it. You sexually harass it a little bit. And it is with this series of short tales, it starts that way. You take the book. You take a look. There are pages in it. You move. You take the cigars. It's, you know, you most of all the experiences you have for your own pleasure, your own convenience, are 70% in your head. It's in your head. You make of it what you decide to make of it.
You're right.
You invest your time in it.
Yeah.
So the whole idea of sitting down with your book, opening it, going through the pages, taking the cigars, touching the cigars, there is something to it. And you enjoy it at the level you want, no obligation, but very easy to commit to this little dimension extra with this presentation. I enjoy it very much.
Yeah, I agree. And the funny thing is, I said I put them in, I have a real office where, you know, we use it. My wife uses that room a lot to do reading and stuff. So when I put the boxes in there, she's like, "You're not putting cigar boxes in the bookshelf." I said, no, there are actually stories in there. She's like, "Really?" I'm like, "Yeah." I said, "Yeah." So I was off the hook with that. I
had to learn. I had to learn for cultural reasons that you can put a coyote in the short tail number one, a short 45 in the short tail number six. There are many uses that can be done with those boxes.
I like that.
Jewelry or cash in case you get burglarized.
Yeah, I liked it. The trade show, how you have the bookshelf set up with that too. Really, I like that whole look of the booth there too. That was, yep. And then on the other side, you have one side of the booth has like the study with the library, if you may, and then the other side is a view of the factory. Like I said, when I went to the factory, I'm like, that's the trade show booth. They almost look identical when you go into the factory. It was amazing how you recreated that.
The colors are exactly the same. Colors, the same.
Literally, people. Yeah.
Oh, this is great. We want people to feel like in family in a trade show. Well, let's set up a library. Let's sit down. We actually had the fireplace crackling and everything electrically. Uh-huh. Crackling around. Let's in the middle of a trade show, it makes it pretty different. But I hope you had our coffee in the other side.
Yes. Oh, I did. I did have the coffee. Yes. Mention the coffee. Yeah. In fact, you guys gave us some coffee to take home from the DR on top of that, which was great because that coffee's great. And I'm a big coffee guy. And cookies, yeah. Oh, we had some of those.
And the cookies were difficult to import, you know, finding all the paper and everything, because they were really artisanal. They're the same we used during the cigar festival. Nearcast found these people, but they do those great little cookies. They're really, really addictive.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So the cigar we should mention as well was the one you released last year. The great Connecticut shade cigar, the Saga Celez, gives you guys a regular Connecticut shade cigar now that you have in the portfolio.
Well, it's like everything. One does a little bit when what we like and everything. But, you know, the 2 years ago, there was this crave about Connecticut wrappers. We played a little bit with it. Till we find something we really like. We wanted to do a different one because that we do our own signature product and it has to taste this different. And this is a cigar and the name is perfect because Solas, it's your own time, your leisure, what you like. And that cigar is exactly that. So you enjoy your own time. This is a milder cigar. It's all Dominican tobacco. I have buddies in Connecticut, which know the Connecticut tobacco very well, and they always say, "You're sure there's no broadleaf in there?" Yeah, I'm pretty sure there's no broadleaf there. because there is this sweet going on. We managed a way to harness the mild bitterness you have to find in a wrapper into something a little bit more richer with a little bit more volume. And yet it's a mild cigar, but it's flavorful. So it entertains. The other day, and I'm not lying to you. If I look at it, I still have the bottle from a tasting I did from a brand not paying your sponsorship. And we did a Zoom tasting, and they thought it was ballsy to take a milder cigar for a 12-year-old, because you know, a 12-year-old would be a little bit more attacking on the palate. It's right. Less round, no matter the brand. I believe I proved the point. The Sagasolas being mild, so easy to smoke. It's really with no difficulty. The draw is a little bit, we worked on the draw. This doesn't just happen, so that the draw is a little bit easier and that you get all those flavors in it. And it went really, really, really well with this stronger whiskey. So it's a cigar that we did in traditional sizes. There is a Churchill, which I believe it's you know, every line of cigars, you have different sizes, but there is one side where somehow the blend consolidates a little bit better, no matter the adaptation you do for size, which is the ability of the blender to go around and adapt the size. There's always one size where, hey, no matter, for me, this is where the blend sticks the most. And definitely in the Solas is the Churchill. And Churchill is like a,
that was my
it's,
size.
It's a size that's not there anymore. Really. Mm-hmm. But in Solas, I strongly recommend to try the Churchill.
I agree. I'm definitely on the Churchill side. And what I did, Jean-Michel, is when I started smoking these cigars, I actually did what it was intended to do. I smoked them later in the day, right? To see, because sometimes everyone says Connecticut, it's a great morning smoke, and you know. But smoking those later in the day, yes, that was a good test, because I totally got everything that, you know, there was tons of flavor with that cigar. I didn't feel like I was missing out on anything, you know. So I think what you achieved with that was certainly validated, at least, you know, from smoking those. But it was great smoking those cigars. You gave us those cigars when we had the coffee out at the farm, when you were the coffee over the open fire with it grinding the beans by hand. That was great too. So.
Traditional roasted coffee right there.
That was
a bad coffee, right?
Yeah. and then I made the Bloody Mary too after that. May have not been the best idea for me in the heat, but but the Bloody Mary was good.
Well, this is a tradition in the Los Reyes Cigars, is that we have this hangover table. People have usually partied a little bit the day before, and they don't listen to us really well at the beginning. So we have this hangover table, which will marry all kinds of pills, legal ones, all kinds of pills for your headaches and stomach aches and whatever stuff, and Bloody Mary and beer for the ones who want to follow. But we call it the hangover table, and that's a tradition. I believe the day we won't have it, we will have a lot of people.
Yep, exactly.
Listen, listening to you, I'm gonna light up a size who's not released. It's the Sagasolas in Corona.
Oh, nice.
Well, very nice. Yeah.
I know that I show it to you. I have to send you some. But
you do. Yes, you do. Oh, that's awesome.
That's pretty nice.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Awesome. Yeah.
As you know, there is only Gordo, Robusto, and Churchill in the market. But this is definitely, we thought when we select the cigars that people are going to be smoking right there on the field, again, easy. I think if you can sum up, it's really easy. It's flavorful, but it's easy. Everybody will say it's flavorful. Well, it's easy. So whenever you try the Sagasolas for the first time, maybe it's because you're over-smoked at night or it's early in the morning, try it the first time and I think you'll stay with it, because there is a lot of flavor to that cigar.
No, I agree. I totally agree with that. For sure. It was one of the I enjoyed that one a lot. Like you said, the Churchill was the size that really kind of clicked with me. So I'm glad to hear that. Aaron, any other questions?
You'll be glad to know that we all agree on that. All sometimes right. We have different opinions on sizes, but right. Nirka, me, Pedro, everybody around, we definitely agree on the Churchill thing.
No, I it's awesome. And it's hard to get a good Connecticut shade in the Churchill too. So I'll say that. I haven't, you know, there's not a lot of them in the Churchill that have worked for me, but this one did. Aaron, any other questions on the branding stuff that we've talked about, the brands?
Not necessarily a question, but just maybe a comment on, you know, some of the Saga, various Saga lines using the unique cutouts on the bands.
Yeah.
Like on the Salas, it's just two bands. It looks like one band, but it's two bands. So you got this, the primary band underneath, it's got this cutout here. And then over that cutout is the Saga band. And you can see the, you know, the wrapper underneath. And for, with the Salas, it's not so much different from the band gold, but for the short tails lines, you can definitely see that kind of shine through. So it's such a unique kind of added detail to the packaging that I think is a nice touch.
Yeah, I agree. I remember when you changed to that. Originally, they weren't like that. And then you changed to the cutout.
It's because we were trying for over a year to find somebody, and actually, no, the technology has involved a whole lot. But when the first time we actually could cut out through a cigar like that, it was really difficult. Obviously, not done with dies because dies will break with such intricate details, and you know, commercially printing on stacks of gold dust paper with laser created all kinds of problems. Again, technology has improved, and probably in three weeks it would have improved it a lot. But the first year, we know and work with every band manufacturer in the planet, the bigger names, as you know, and they really could not come up with a solution. They finally did. Vidak was the one from Holland who actually found a solution, but a solution that they couldn't even do themselves. They had to find somebody else to do it from another industry. And that's how we could get what we wanted from the beginning, which was this stencil look where you could actually see the tobacco. And the reason in the Solas it goes a little different than in the others, which there is a primary and a secondary band, and as Aaron has just shown, it's because we couldn't get the contrast of the golden wrapper and the number. So when putting this little window, we just put the band of sight a little bit further away, and it just increases the contrast.
Yeah.
Not that it certainly it's fluorescent, but it does increase the contrast a little bit, and you have a lot more angles where you could actually read the word Saga. But as you say, it's attention to detail, is making sure the bands are placed the right way that they don't move.
Yes.
But this, we really enjoy this. We literally get a kick out of that, and I believe that's what the Pazzo thing comes back. We are, and we speak the same Pazzo language at the factory.
Very nice. You guys did something I think that was very, not just unique, but it was groundbreaking a few years ago. You were involved with the launch of UPS Cigars Direct, which, you know, I remember when you launched it at the trade, you had the UPS guys at the trade show, and now we're hearing a lot of companies have really gotten on board with this. It's a unique concept in terms of how you guys are distributing your cigars. Can you talk a little about that program for people who may not be familiar with that?
It was really fun. And actually, you said we brought in the people of UPS at the show, and nobody would believe us. Yeah, I ship with UPS. Yeah, this is not the same thing. It's a program that I personally developed this with somebody at UPS and countless conference calls with dozens of people. They have logistics in this continent and accounting in this and lawyers in that, and repeating things for 14 months before we could actually do a dry test. Because the whole idea was it is to be able to ship from factory to the retailers. And I insist this because this is a program who only works for legal reasons, business to business, licensed business, and by the way, to make it possible in a fast way to pass the border, it's only available to products who are capped by the S-chip. So we're talking premium cigars. Mm-hmm. It's really made for premium cigars. And it allows shops to be able to order the product without having to go through minimum orders, packing up inventory. And of course, for us, it cuts both ways, because sometimes it's easier to just sell a lot of inventory and have you fight about it. But after our experience many years ago with the catalogs, we really wanted to you know, to change that and to make more of an alliance with the brick and mortars, and for them for it to be really easy. And basically, with the pandemic, we often lost an extra day, but people order many, many ways, including WhatsApp. And 3 days later, from the Dominican Republic, their cigars are there. And the first thing was for people who actually grabbed the concept was, really, and are the taxes paid? And we, yes, they get an invoice from the US, all federal taxes paid, as shipped, user fees, all that is done. You cannot be more legal. UPS would not play with something who's completely legal. It's completely legal, and they'll get the product in 3 days from the factory. We can sign the boxes. It's kind of a, I think it entitles the brick and mortars a little bit more. They are more in contact. You know, I order from the guy, from the real guy, and it goes there, and I bring this to you. It's more getting back to what a brick and mortar is. You know, service boutique. Used to be that. Boutique used to be a luxury shop, right, in the Champs-Élysées, where everything was uber expensive, but you could get anything. That is boutique. And this is bringing back a little bit this context. So this program sounds easy, but because of the difficulties of taxes in the US, having the federal taxes, having to be paid on the first invoice and not on the import invoices, it was a little bit technical to float the papers right the right way, but we've been doing this since 2016.
Yep.
Mark. And it's doing quite well. We have no intention to change that. And as you say, there is more and more people realize this is a lot better. This is a lot better. It creates a bond really with retailers. And they rightfully so feel a little bit more connected with their product. This is not something that's dropped by a ice cream truck with a number. It's something else.
Yeah, and the other thing is customs. The customs piece is all handled by them as well, which is, again, you know, that's a big load off. I know companies like Matilde, MLB, Phil Zengi's gone to it now, and this has really helped them because they have this piece now. Yeah, yeah. So,
you know, it does pay the federal taxes. The local taxes is something different, but yeah, the federal taxes are completely paid.
Yeah.
It's been paid. The basically, customs is cleared before the cigars reach the United States. You know, UPS is kind of the half-brother of the U.S. border. It goes through their hub in St. Louis, and basically, I mean, all the departments of the U.S. government are inside their facilities. You know, so if your package gets delayed, it's because they're having coffee. So the delay is not going to be very noticeable. It goes really, really fast. You remember even in August, the famous FDA stopped with this formula. It was 11 years old and stuff. And everybody got their cargo stopped in Miami. We had a 3-hour delay that day, the 8th of August, 2016. 3 hours. Wow. That's it.
Wow. And the timing couldn't have been better for this for you guys, because it was around the time where FedEx had basically stopped tobacco shipments, and everyone was starting to ask the question on whether UPS was going to be next. And here you guys launched this program, and here's a commitment from UPS that they've designed a whole program around this right now. I thought it was a very interesting move they made, because now they kind of took what their competitors were getting out of this business, and here's UPS now strengthening what they're doing here.
They committed to it.
Yeah, yeah.
They really committed to it. So the program is called Cigar Direct. It's an app within the UPS office. It's not program Jean-Michel having fun. It's based on the Word East program, and Word East was a program from a couple of decades ago, was known with the 1-800 flowers, and people would order flowers and get them the next day somewhere. And they actually originated from Costa Rica. Yeah. And basically the principle is consolidating cargo in the entrance to the United States. Once they clear border, I mean, one of the stickers gets ripped off and the other one gets scanned and it goes to the shop.
Yeah.
And everything has been cleared. The S-ship has been paid. Everything is, I'm guessing the government cannot be happier than that for their money, because basically, it's a very simple program. You enter 1 million cigars, you owe me a million times 0.426 cents. That's it. Yeah. That's the way it works. Really easy to audit. And again, I make it probably sounds a little bit easier than it actually was to put this together, but it works flawlessly. That's the truth. It works flawlessly. And when there is a delay, maybe because you have a rain and wind storm in North Carolina, I don't know, but those are the reasons. It's not, it's UPS delivery delays. It's nothing else.
Yeah. Very, very true.
It's a pretty nice thing.
Yeah.
And I had the occasion to sit down and meet with VPs of UPS. And I'm not talking Dominican Republic. I'm talking VPs of UPS worldwide. I mean, who came down and met with me. And I mean, as much as I love to blow my own horn, I mean, I'm not that important. They actually sat down and met with me. So they are interested. They are committed. And they see probably that all those difficulties, whether it's for tobacco or something else, it's the way of the future. That's the way you get to do your closest version to the just on time from Gap. That's the way. And that's good for everybody, as long as the merchandise is when you need it.
I agree. I think it was a great thing that you guys did. So that, yeah, I think I know people already in Nicaragua were asking me about it. I said, I don't know how it works in Nicaragua. I said, I think it's only a DR thing right now, but people have asked me about it several times already.
I know that in Nicaragua they want it. I met with the manager of the country because I'm trying to help on this. I believe it's for a good cause. Unluckily, it's in Dominican Republic. UPS is fully part of the U.S. ownership.
Right.
So every employee of UPS in the DR is an employee of UPS U.S.
Right.
And in Nicaragua, luckily, they've worked through a third agency, and that probably will make things more complicated, if not impossible. Really, I met with them several times trying to build that. I don't know where they are at this level, so I don't know if they can do it in Nicaragua at all. But in the DR, we can, because it's a true UPS operation. Every employee here has an email at ups.com, not at UPSDR or whatever. Mm-hmm. They're true whole employees of UPS. They have operations, they have a plane landing. In Santo Domingo, we're trying really hard to get a plane in Santiago.
Yeah,
because that would be for the same price, which is, I mean, we basically when people buy more than six boxes, we give the transport for free.
Okay,
it's simple. You get better prices.
Yeah,
but for the same price, it would allow us to ship next day because we only have one speed out of the Dominican Republic. Yeah. But here we need to go to Santo Domingo and there to whatever. So it's the future is even better, faster, easier for real, for brick and mortar, be able to defend themselves in an easier way. They can get the people's cigar in their hands really easy without compromising financials and problems that can hurt brick and mortars. But we thought it was all good.
Very, very good. Excellent program. I just want a couple more things I want to mention. The Debonair House, which is right next to the factory. I just got to rave about that place. That's just a spectacular place you guys have there. The guys from Federation were telling me about it. And that's just an incredible place is what I'm just going to say. It's just like you can smoke everywhere there, which was great. And it's like a mini resort there almost. And it's just well run. It's clean. It's really beautiful. And like there were a couple of times I'm like, yeah, I'll just hang out here for a few hours. It was great. So I really, really enjoyed that piece as well. Thanks for sharing that with us.
Well, you know, the smoking everywhere thing comes a little naturally to us. And I had a lot, unluckily, the pandemic has made us close Saga restaurant in the center of town. The Reyes family could not have it any other way. This is too great of a restaurant to leave on takeaway or curbside and near the lows, didn't allow us to give service without plastic and stuff. And restaurant brags about the temperature of the meat. You cannot do that with plastic.
Yeah.
I mean, it killed the spirit. So Saga will be back, but we interrupted it indefinitely. We basically closed the place. But this was a place where people got amazed. They would come and feel awkward because you could smoke.
Yeah.
You could smoke. You could be eating a tomahawk steak, which was the signature dish, and have a cigar. But it comes naturally to us. It's. I mean, this is cigar country. This is Dominican Republic. You know, my brother says that I live in the Dominican Republic because to smoke the amount of cigars I smoke daily, I I should need the budget of a small independent country. and he may be right in the Frisian level that maybe, but I enjoyed every moment of it. It's yeah. something we do, and it to us it comes naturally. We as well the social reflexes. We're not going to bother yeah. somebody by smoking. It's but it's natural. It's a lot easier.
Yeah.
It's definitely a lot easier.
Yeah, no, I agree. And actually, we have a Cattle Baron Cigars steak question of the night. Actually, it was on Saga Restaurant. Which I've been at three times. It's my favorite restaurant anywhere. I mean, I'm really serious. But I was going to ask you, tell us what makes that tomahawk so special at Saga Restaurant. I mean, that thing is, how do you like that tomahawk cooked is my question.
Oh, I'm first of all, the good thing about the presentation of the tomahawk steak there is that it's served on a block of salt, Himalayan yep. salt, with just put right there in an oven. So the secret is you have to get as red as you can. I mean, Kellner says that when you get your fork next to it, I want to hear it say moo. And that's the whole cook I want. Because basically you can actually get it to be at your level. You just leave it a little bit more on the salt stone or just, and it's going to be cooked as you want. I'm blessed of having a mother from Spain and a father from Belgium. And that basically allows me to like every kind of meat in the array of meats. But I have to say, if you're taking a thick tomahawk, it shouldn't be overcooked. It shouldn't be medium cooked. I mean, it's like wasting it. You're really losing a part of it. And as far as the secret is, the dry age was handled by the restaurant. It was not bought by that vacuum from nobody. It's something that was handled by the restaurant. So the meat gets exactly the point it was intended. And you know, Mr. Reyes, Augusto Reyes, near Gaspar, he's a foodie. He loves food. And the best secret to actually give something good to people is to enjoy it yourself. And we do the same with cigars.
Yeah,
but we do. If we like it ourselves, if Nirka was not somebody who would enjoy smoking cigars, well, her opinions about cigars would be different. Would be not. This is really. It's an involved opinion. It's an educated opinion, and it's an involved opinion.
Yeah. No, I and what you said. I normally don't like things on the rarer side, but everyone was telling me try it on the rarer side, and I totally agree with that. That was the way to go with that. That's what I'm just saying. And it's the best. It's my favorite restaurant in the world. I mean, the three times I had there have just been exceptional. I know Bear was there with me once too. We were down the year before, it lived up. It's I can't wait. But we'll reopen. You're saying right once the pandemic clears.
As soon as the pandemic clears, and more than most probably, that would be an even better experience.
Yep.
Because again, it's like in the cigar factory, everything we do is just going to be better. Yep. It's the whole idea, and expect that from Saga Restaurant for sure.
Yep.
And I'm telling you, the main secret is because the Reyes really enjoyed us. Mm-hmm. I'm not even talking about. I really, really, really enjoyed it. But
yeah. Yeah,
that's the best secret.
Yeah,
to get to a good product.
No, I agree. I totally agree. All right. What we want to do is want to get to what we're smoking actually tonight. And as always, our sponsors is Tailored Smoke, located in the heart of downtown Charlotte's epicenter, and now just outside the Charlotte Motor Speedway in Concord, North Carolina. Tailored Smoke is your one-stop shop for a tailored smoke experience. Aaron, what are you smoking tonight?
I'm smoking Salaz, and I'm smoking the Gordo Vitola. And this is a really well-executed kind of traditional Connecticut shade offering. I mean, you get the kind of the woodiness with a little bit of hay in there. It's got a nice kind of mild creaminess to it, kind of really a faint sweetness kind of underlying in there. Retrohale's quite smooth. You get some of that, you know, dry wood in there, a little bit of the creaminess as well. And the construction is impeccable. I mean, the draw is perfect. Sometimes on the Gordo, you can get a little bit of a too loose of a draw, but it works out perfectly. So, yeah, I'm really enjoying it in this Vitola. What do you got going on today, Will?
And I'm smoking the cigar of the year of 2019 on Cigar Coupe, the Saga Short Tales Tomo 6, the sixth element, El Tabaco. This is a two-year aged one I'm smoking right now. So this has some serious age on it. And it just continues to just be a flavor bomb, this cigar. You get some of those mocha notes. You get the earthy notes. So a little bit of red pepper, a little dried fruit on this thing. It's in the medium range. It's a very approachable cigar. The combustion is fantastic on this thing. It's a slow smoking cigar. I've been smoking it the whole time, but one that you could really savor. And like I said, 2 years of age, it's smoking just as good as when it's cigar of the year. So in my book, this is like, I can't say enough about this cigar. It's a spectacular cigar. It's one of my favorite cigars that's been released in the last 10 years.
Nice.
Yeah. So, all right, Jean-Michel, how are you? Do you have time to do one short segment more? I know we kept you a little late. If it's okay, if you can't,
hit me. I'm okay. I'm not past my bedtime time.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do a couple sponsor reads, and then we'll get into your this last. It's a fun segment, so it's easy, and you won't get into trouble. So at least no, he ain't going to get in trouble this week. All right.
Nurko was saying some not so nice things about him when he was telling the new line. So
oh, he got in trouble for that.
Yeah, she was watching.
Oh no.
I'm not responsible. all right. No, these are fun questions. They're not anything that's going to get him into more trouble. So, let me mention Jerry Tobacco. The authentic Corojo leaf is one of the most robust and flavorful leaves out there. During the golden age of cigars, the Cuba was the leaf of choice to make some of the world's greatest cigars because it is one of the most challenging ones to cultivate. It fell out of favor by the 1990s. In the Hamastran Valley of Honduras, Julio Arroyo took on the challenge of Corojo, growing Corojo from the original seeds. In 2000, he successfully reintroduced authentic Corojo back to the market. With over 50 years' experience in the tobacco business, from growing and curing tobacco to cigar production, the Jerry Tobacco Farm has been able to continue to deliver products to market with authentic Corojo. Jerry Tobacco brings to you the Aladino line. It's available in a 100% authentic Corojo Puro, San Andreas Maduro, Ecuadorian Connecticut Shade, Cameroon, or Habano wrapper that represents that golden age of cigars from 1947 to 1961. Now available at your local retailer, be sure to ask for Jerry Tobacco, a legacy that is tasted in every draw. And by Toscano Cigars, as rustic and strong as the people who smoke them, try Toscano's rustic and full-bodied flavors and aromas. Made in Italy with 100% dark fire-cured tobacco from the United States and Italy, is one of the best-selling cigars in the world. Toscano Cigars are the perfect combination of Italian and American craftsmanship, whether in the traditional long format or the short format Toscanello. Toscano Cigars are dry-cured, handmade, and fire-cured for your enjoyment anytime, anywhere. Visit your local premium cigar retailer today and look for Toscano Cigars today. And by AJ Fernandez Cigars. AJ Fernandez's New World brand is named in the honor of the discovery of tobacco by Christopher Columbus's expedition in 1492. Fernandez collaborated with his father Ishmael on the cigar, which is comprised of a wrapper from Nicaragua covering a binder from the Jalapa Valley and a filler blend of Ometepe, Condega, and Esteli tobaccos. The core line debuted in 2014. It was followed by New World Connecticut, New World Puro Especial, and New World Cameroon. All four blends are able to captivate the palate of any cigar smoker. If you're beginning to discover the fine world of premium handmade cigars, New World Connecticut's for you. If you're into rich, full-bodied blends, Puro Especial's for you. If you're into complex flavors, the New World Cameroon's for you. Finally, if you're into the robust and earthy flavors with notes of espresso, the New World Escuro is definitely for you. Visit www.ajfcigars.com to learn more. And by M-Bombay Cigars. M-Bombay Cigars represent the most admired cigar culture of Cuba. They select the best of best quality tobacco to use in the aging process. M-Bombay Cigars are enrolled in Costa Rica by some of the world's most experienced cigar rollers, giving it a unique smoking experience. The band portrays the detailed and artistic nature of our small industry. Try M-Bombay, Gaia, M-Cuba, and the M-Esteli line. M-Bombay Cigars, where the cigar is a way of life. And finally, by Alec Bradley Cigars. Alec Bradley, Alec Bradley, Alec Bradley, Alec Bradley. Visit alecbradley.com to find out more about their cigars. Live True. So we call this segment the Live True segment by Alec Bradley. They sponsor this. And what we do is we want to find out a little more about you, Jean-Michel. So I have a series of seven questions for you tonight. These are some of them are cigar related and some of them aren't. Okay? And we'll hit you up with these if you so choose.
So hello. I'm usually not really good at that either because I'm too slow or too fast. I'm thinking about other things. Well, what did you say again? But I'll try it.
No, it'll be easy. Trust me. They won't get. So let me. This one's easy. because I may, we may have already given you, you may have already given the answer at the top of the show. Maybe not. But what is your favorite cartoon character?
My favorite movie character? Well, I'm going to say Hans Gruber, just to repeat his name again. Hans Gruber.
Okay. I was going to say, okay, I was going to say cartoon character. Like, is it Pepe Le Pew? But,
oh,
but
cartoon character. I heard movie character.
Oh, okay.
Zoom failed us for the first time tonight. Okay, so let's go with Pepe Le Pew to be able to say Pepe Le Pew.
Okay, so it's both. It's both. So, so
actually, that... it's probably BoJack Horseman, but, you know.
Okay, good one. All right. Your favorite city to visit in the U.S. or elsewhere?
My favorite visit to visit where? Anywhere in the world?
Any city, yeah. Any city in the world that you like to go visit.
I'm a little partial to Brussels, Belgium.
That would make sense.
That would make sense. I've never been there. I got to get to Brussels.
It's the beer and the chocolate, I have to say. Well, you can ask Charlie about the waffles.
Oh, that's a good one.
So we were talking to Jeremiah a few weeks ago, and he said it's the fries and gravy.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I beg to differ. The gravy with fries is a very Canadian concept.
Yes,
which I enjoy as well, my wife being Canadian. But we effectively, we have a very peculiar way to eat fries, which is standing on the street in a corn, you just eat them like this.
Right.
And there's a thousand sauces to go with it. Not gravy, sauces.
Okay.
They have exotic traditional names like kamikaze, suicide, and this kind of things. It's not a really old, but it's a thing, and definitely it's a great drunk. It's a thing that was done in the corners of the streets in Belgium.
I saw it in Stockholm. I didn't try it though, but I saw that in Stockholm on the street. They had a vendor doing that.
Amazingly, in Central America, it's called Dutch fries, and there is no such thing in Holland. It's called Dutch fries, and Americans say French fries.
Yeah.
I think it's for everybody.
Yep.
Yeah.
We just make it an art.
Yeah. All right. And you may or may not have an answer to this, and that's okay, but what is your favorite spectator sport to watch?
Excuse me, Zoom failed us again. My favorite what?
Sport. Like sporting event. What's your favorite sporting event to watch?
Wait, I'm not really big on sports. That's the truth.
That's
if
okay.
If I have a choice, I guess through all my life, boxing with it.
Okay.
Nice. I'm a boxing guy.
Yeah. So Phil would be good to talk to then about it.
Yeah. I can see. Phil loves his boxing. That's for sure. What is your favorite cigar size?
Well, probably in general, as a rule, I believe I'm made for Toros. But then again, I have exceptions in every line because I truly take as a personal religion to find this size where blend actually conforms a little bit better. And that's true for every brand.
Yep. Yeah. I agree with you on that one. That's how I would answer it exactly. It depends. Some people will say, you know, they're stuck on one size, and that's okay too. There's no wrong answer on that.
There is no wrong answer.
Okay. All right. Your favorite holiday besides Christmas? Because everyone answers Christmas. So what is your favorite holiday, not including Christmas?
Well, the best holiday is the holiday you forgot happened. When you're feeling so good trying cigars and, oh my God, is this a holiday again? I'm busy. I mean, that's the best holiday.
There ever. You go. I love that. I like that one a lot.
Yeah.
Well, it does happen.
Yeah. Yeah. Like Pro Cigar is now my favorite holiday. Yeah. I'll say that's a good one.
That's a good one as well. I'm going to keep that one. Let me trademark this right now. Yeah.
Okay. So I know you like music because I heard a lot of music in your car. But what are some of your favorite musical artists or bands?
Wow. My favorite artist or bands. Again, I'm going to have a very honest tobacco answer. It depends. But when I'm traveling over an hour each sense in the middle of the mountains here, going to the factory, I have opera days. I have greasy heavy metal days. I have jazz nice. Days. I have all kinds of days. I don't have a lot of I'm probably old, and I probably listened to most of music who has happened already, till I found some singer in the middle of everything. Today I was listening to Elle King. She's not old. I thought it was great. I mean, I like to, it's like cigars, really. How do I feel today? What am I going to do with it?
All right, so here's an audible on that one. Let's do a pairing exercise. So give me a Saga cigar that pairs with opera. Give me a Saga cigar that pairs with the heavy metal. Let's just put those two for now. Let's see what you can come up with.
That's a good one. That's a good one, Berm. That's a good one.
A pairing. Remember, a pairing is really a pairing where you actually create a third thing.
Yes.
Yep.
So probably opera will go well with the Golden Age, or maybe with the Short Tail number one, something that you can, you know, deep in, sinking, being my moment, I'm the man, and get an aria, something Mozart, not necessarily Wagner, something light but strong.
Yeah.
Right. It probably would be that. For greasy heavy metal, it's a very good question. it's something that's not easy to answer, but somehow I want to answer it. I really do want to nail that one, but it's a complicated one. What would be, I mean, the perfect cigar for heavy metal from what we have? I don't know. I'll have my cake and eat it too. I'll have a Short Tail number six.
I was thinking that one. That was the one I was thinking too. That's a very good one. Nice. Very nice. Good job, Jean-Michel.
All right.
And here's my last question here. If there was a TV show about you, your whatever, what would the name of it be?
What would be the name of the TV show? That's what you said?
Yep.
What would
And you thought reality TV was the worst.
That's what I actually changed the word from reality TV. And that was how I worded it originally.
I think that should be the title. And you thought reality TV was the worst.
And it would star Pepe Le Pew and Alan Rickman, who plays Hans Gruber.
I mean, I would not take it any other way. I won't sign up for the rights if that normal. And luckily, it's just going to be just me, Pepe Le Pew, I'm afraid.
All right. Well, Jean-Michel, first of all, I want to thank you for being on the show. And I want to thank you and Nurka and everyone for the support of what we've done here. You guys have been with us before this even started here, back on my old show. You've been with us from day one. And it means a lot. This show wouldn't have been, without your support, we would not have had this show. And I just love what you guys are doing, and I love talking to you guys. And I can't wait to get back to the DR and hang out with you guys all again.
Well, I hope you come and visit us again. And I have to say, well, thank you for having me. Thank you for allowing us to be a little bit part of this show, because it's, from the beginning, you strike us for being a little bit different. There are a lot, but I truly believe if there is one person who's uncontested in this, that nobody says, yeah, but he only says crazy things or whatever other things were said about other people. You're taking seriously the no teasers and everything. It's a hashtag now, but it used to be a fact. Not that it isn't anymore, but it's a hashtag now.
It became a
and we kind of like that. It's kind of the spirit of what we do. Make your own saga hashtag.
It's beautiful, yeah. And like I said, it's really like I said. Every show starts off. We talk sagas the first thing we mention, and that's how the show will be. Going forward, so we'll have you back for sure, and we waited a long time to get you on. And Nurker, we want to get Nurker on as well, so we really appreciate it.
And I think you should.
Yep.
And I think you should have Nurker, because it's probably quite different. I don't think you had that many women on your show.
We've only had three, I think. So we've been behind in that area, and I got to talk to Nurker down at we were a little rushed, unfortunately. But we had, I learned so much from her in that conversation. It helps me learn the story and tell your story so much better from the conversation I had with her and obviously with you, the times we've talked. So, yeah, thank you as well.
Well, I mean, put it in your agenda. I know you work a long time or whatever, but it should be interesting. She's definitely a different voice in this industry.
No, she's great. She's great. One of the great women in our industry for sure. So, yeah, we need to get more women on the show. People like when we have women on the show too. So we work better at that. So, and we've had some really good ones on. So, thank you so much, Jean-Michel.
Yes, thank you, Jean-Michel.
Thank you for having me. And thank you, Aaron. You didn't say a lot of things, but
I did. I saved it for the music question.
I enjoyed your heavy metal, but yeah, you made it count right there.
Exactly.
All right. Thank you, Nurker, as well. She said some kind things, so appreciate it. And we'll be seeing you guys hopefully sooner than later.
Okay, yes. Let's hope to make it real soon.
All right. That's Jean-Michel Louis. Take care, and we'll be seeing you. Jean-Michel Louis of Los Reyes Cigars. So we got one more segment we're going to be doing on the show here. But first, what we will do is we will do a quick sponsor word, and we'll get into the last segment here. I want to mention Dumbarton Tobacco and Trust. With Dumbarton Tobacco and Trust, master blender Steve Saca set out to create Puro Son Compromiso, cigars without compromise. This represents an expression of Saca's closely held values and attests in three simple words everything Saca wants to accomplish. Cigars are more than a passion, Saca. They are a way of life. As for the brands of Dumbarton Tobacco and Trust, Sobra Mesa, Mi Querida, Umbagog, Muerto de Saca, Todos los Dias, and Sin Compromiso at your local tobacconist. And by La Aurora Cigars. In the heart of Santiago, Dominican Republic, on the rolling floor at the La Aurora Cigar Factory is a section reserved only for the elite, the best of the best. These elite cigar rollers work for over 10 years to simply get the opportunity to make a historic cigar. Those cigars are the La Aurora Preferidos, featuring six different wrappers in a beautifully packaged perfecto shape. La Aurora Preferidos have been the preferred cigar of the Leon family for 117 years. Take part in a legendary tradition that started the Dominican cigar industry. Look to the lion, La Aurora Cigars. Weird Dominican defined. And by J.C. Newman Cigar Company. Founded in 1895 by Julius Caesar Newman, the J.C. Newman Cigar Company is the oldest family-owned premium cigar maker in America. For four generations and 125 years, J.C. Newman has been handcrafting many of the world's finest cigars. J.C. Newman is headquartered in an iconic 110-year-old-plus cigar factory in the Ybor City National Historic Landmark District in Tampa, Florida. At this factory known as Elwood Hall, J.C. Newman rolls premium cigars by hand and hand-operated antique cigar machines. The J.C. Newman Pensa factory is the second largest in Nicaragua, and it's where Brickhouse, Pillar de Mar, El Baton, Quorum, and Yagua cigars are hand-rolled. J.C. Newman's Diamond Crown, Maximus, Julius Caesar, and Black Diamond cigars are handmade by Tabacalera A. Fuente in the Dominican Republic. Together with its longtime partners, the Arturo Fuente family, the Newmans founded the Cigar Family Charitable Foundation, which supports low-income families in the Dominican Republic with education, healthcare, vocational training, and clean water. Visit jcnewman.com to learn more. And by Casa Cuevas Cigars, the Cuevas family has four generations of experience in cigar making. For many years, they have manufactured cigars for many industry leaders at a Las Lavas factory in the Dominican Republic. Now the Cuevas family brings their very own brand to market with Casa Cuevas Cigars. Try Casa Cuevas Connecticut, the Casa Cuevas Habano, the Casa Cuevas Maduro, La Mandaria, and the Cuevas Reserva line. If they don't carry it, be sure to ask your local retailer for Casa Cuevas Cigars. Casa Cuevas Cigars, from our casa to yours. And finally, by Aventura Cigars. Aventura the Explorer is the first creation by Marcel Noble and Henderson Ventura. Immediately after lighting up the Explorer, the Mexican wrapper will delight the aficionado with its dark chocolate flavor. After a while and pleasure, the Dominican filler will flatter the aficionado's palate with wonderful spicy and leather aromas and unite it with the wooden sweetness from Ecuador. Try Aventura the Explorer and explore the wonderful experience. Well, going back, we're getting into our deliberation segment. Just before we kind of get into this part, Aaron, since I'll just do a slight audible here. Thoughts on how the World Series ended?
It went about as I expected.
Yeah.
I think I said it was going to go six games. So I think that kind of all played out around the right way. I just think that in that last game, I think that there was definitely some poor managerial decisions. I think that it's, in this day and age of how media works and all that stuff, you know, people really pounce anytime any decision doesn't work out, and it's all, you know, hindsight, and people really just take that, you know, that stance and they go at them. But, I think you and I would both say we would not have made that decision at that point. in taking out the starting pitcher. But there's been decisions like that in every sport, every season that happens. And, you know, it just happened to happen in the deciding game of the World Series this time. And it was a big deal.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people were asking me because I really tore into AJ Hinch last year with his decision making. To me, I was having problems with Hinch throughout the playoffs. It wasn't just like one thing. This Cash one, I don't think up until that point people would say he was managing a bad series. I think that he had a bad game in game six. I'm going to agree with that. But I don't think it was the same scenario there. Given, you know, Tampa was still a big underdog in this series. Well, I think last year you could argue that Houston was a favorite in the series.
Sure.
So, yeah, I kind of agree with you on that. The Blake Snell, and I didn't know about this until after I was on the air with Bear, so I didn't know what had happened. I went back and watched the game the next morning. So I already knew about the Blake Snell thing, so I didn't know it. But, yeah, I was like, I wanted to see if in that scenario, I just scratched my head on that one. And unfortunately, he's going to be remembered for that, Kevin Cash. That's going to be one that's going
to
stick.
Yeah, it's I think you have to determine how the team sees him now going forward. You know, you don't know how many opportunities you're going to get back to go to the series and things like that. And then if the manager made a decision that kind of took the game out of your hands, I know Blake Snell wasn't happy about it when he got taken out. I mean, he was very professional about how he handled it, but you could see it in his face that he was not happy to be getting pulled out of that game.
But it was a similar scenario to last year when Hinch pulled out his guy. Verlander. It was Verlander, right? Yeah. It was the guy who got you to the dance. Very similar. I don't know if he was, and it puzzled me more because why go to Snell wasn't going to pitch game seven. So why even tap into the bullpen at that point?
It's the last game this guy's pitching all season.
Yeah.
You know,
let him go.
You know, I understand that he has some injury history and all that stuff, but he's in the mid 70s in pitches. He's given up two hits. I think the next three guys that he was facing, he had struck them out every at bat ahead of that. So there was really nothing. Like even if you look at the analytics to it, there wasn't really much that would tell you to take him out.
Yeah.
So.
You know, I know we have like friends who are Dodger fans, like Dave Jones, Tor Campbell. My friend Jeremy, I know they waited a long time for this. So I was kind of glad for them for that. They waited a long time, and, so I was happy for them. I actually was watching the L.A. news the next day as well. I always like to see the reaction of a city. I don't know. It was like – I thought it was a great thing that happened for them. They seem very low-key about it out there. I think I was mentioning even the looting down there and the ransacking was just like totally downplayed. I was like, wow. I was like, they're really downplaying this. Yeah, there was some damage. I was, wow, I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
But
it's unfortunate that even happens at any celebration.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it happened in Philly too. So I'm not, it's New York. It hadn't happened in New York. I mean, that could change in the future, obviously.
Yeah.
But we never had that new. But I was satisfied with the baseball season as a whole. I mean, I think shorter season, but we got baseball. And the other thing I say, the Dodgers were the first team to go through four rounds to win a championship. So
you
got to give them that too as well.
Yep.
So that's kind of a whole different now. So we'll see. It's going to be very – I mean, I'm already – a lot of interesting things already on the offseason with, we're going to – the hot stove is going to be very interesting.
Oh, yeah.
Phillies are looking for a GM right now. They got to sign the catcher. We got a lot to think about right now. And you guys have to get a new guy for the A's as well to run it. Yep. So I think they'll find someone. I think I had a guess. Billy Beane's going to be heavily involved with picking his successor.
I would think so. Yeah.
Yeah. I think he's leaving on good terms. It sounds like so. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But anyway, digress. Tonight I wanted to talk a little about, there's a lot of – everyone wants – I know there's things going on right now, right, that we could talk about that – I don't know. I wanted to put a more positive spin on conversation tonight rather than what we're seeing go on right now. So And I looked at some, I said, well, I don't know, let's go with something that I thought was, I was kind of thinking about. And it's the idea of annual limited releases. Right. Mm-hmm. And people are probably going, oh, you're really going to talk about it. Yeah, no, we are. And I don't know, this year it was very interesting. I started really thinking about this. And what I'm defining as an annual limited release is it's a company that comes out with a cigar once a year in a series. And they kind of change it up from year to year.
Right.
So maybe they'll change the size. Maybe they'll change the blend.
Yep.
But that I wanted to kind of, but there's a lot of them that are out there. And I just wanted to talk a little about those. So I guess my first question to you is, what makes a good annual limited release for you?
It would go along the same lines as any kind of limited release, regardless if it's annual or not. I just think that a limited release should definitely be a good cigar. It should be a bit unique from the other offerings in the portfolio. It should be, you know, you trying to showcase something special. It shouldn't just be another blend that you just kind of place this moniker on. So I think it carries a little extra cachet to it, or it should at least.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. You know, and we'll talk about when maybe they go too long in a second. And some of them have gone a long time. I mean, some of the, when we get into some of these, when is there a point do you think the limited series should be retired though? Like, okay, we've done this enough and now it's time.
I think if you're if you're not producing cigars at a high enough level, where they stand out, if you're having a few down years, maybe you should be retired at that point. You know, go back to the drawing board, take a few years off, come up with something special again, and then go for it. You know, try another attempt at it.
I agree. One that comes to mind, and they did retire it finally, was Oliva's Siri V Maduro. Was a good again. So, I mean, that was, when I started smoking, that was one of the most anticipated cigars every fall. And originally they would do different blends, and then they eventually settled on a San Andreas blend, and then they changed the size of that, and eventually they just were just releasing Gordos like 3 or 4 years in a row. And right. I was like, okay, I think at that point, if they're not going to, you know, at this point, make it a limited production and put it into your portfolio. And that's kind of what they did eventually. So I thought that was a case where they retired it, and good for them. Maybe they could come up with something. I see they're doing millennial releases for Europe now. So they're kind of doing something a little different. But yeah, that's kind of, I think there's a point where they do need to be retired.
Yeah.
How about like the ones like, for example, someone who does limited releases is like James Brown.
Yeah.
Like, he tends to release the same cigar. Maybe he'll change it up a little from time to time, but but he tends to have like certain times of the year he releases his cigar. Maybe there's not a lot of change. Is that something that excites you? Do you look forward to that? How do you deal with those?
I mean, I think it's fine to do that. Just because, I mean, obviously you're going, you know, year crop to crop and stuff like that. So you're getting, you know, you're getting a kind of a slightly different iteration. I don't think the goal is to try to blend the same cigar year after year just to make it available. You know, I think it's more open to like, you know, variations in tobacco or whatever tweaks he makes to make a little bit of a difference. So I think it's okay to do that.
Yeah.
Because if it is limited and it's something that you enjoy and you know that it's going to be an annual thing, you can kind of do your years and do your comparison between year to year. And then you can sit on them and you can, you know, revisit one from 2 or 3 years ago compared to a one from the current year and all that kind of stuff. So I think it's kind of a fun exercise to do.
Yeah. I know Viaje's done some of those, and I've always liked comparing those from year to year as well, even though the blends are pretty much, some he changes up, but again, I kind of always like comparing the vintage from the year before. Or yep. A couple years ago and see. And it does make it interesting. So I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
Shouldn't there be a point where one of these annual releases should just be put into regular production? Do you think that's a good thing?
I mean, I think if there's enough demand for it and it's going to sell, sure. If you've got enough tobacco, if the tobacco itself wasn't the limiting factor for it, and you can do it, I think that's okay to do it. you know, you're going to have the people, I think we've talked about it before, where you have people that, you know, complain, oh, this was supposed to be a limited thing and I invested this amount of money in it. Now it's regular production. It's not as special. But I mean, don't we all just want to smoke good cigars? If it's a good cigar and they can make it regular production, just do it.
Yeah, I remember, like, the guy who took a big beating on that was Crown Heads and Huber when he took the first Los Calaveras and made it La Imperiosa. But I argued, I thought he did something a little different. He came up with different sizes of it.
Yeah.
So the Los Calaveras sizes weren't that, and he ended up releasing different sizes, and they're going to taste different, certainly, because they're different sizes. That's up to you if you think it's a good or a bad. But he definitely took a hit because there were a lot of people who were buying up those Los Calaveras in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So sure. I think you got to be careful. You don't want to do it with every one of those. Like La Palina with their TAAs do it. But I think people know what they're doing with that is they release it to the TAA in one size, and then the following year they release it generally and they expand it to a different line. So, I mean, that's an example of that. So with the TAA, I kind of like that model a bit, especially if, you know, you're not just releasing anything to the TAA. If you're printing on doing a launch of the line, and, I'm not saying you're going to love every one of those La Palina TAAs. Some of them I like better than others. So yeah, I kind of see that as well with that. Going with that. What are some of the, like, personally, what are some of the annual limited releases? And I know which one you're going to say, too. Like, I got a feeling.
You do know one of them, at least. And I have two that I'll mention.
Yeah, mention your.
The first one I'll mention is the Crux Limitada of the show.
Okay.
Is that the one that you thought I was going to mention?
No, but that was one of mine. Okay. Yeah, but go ahead. Yeah.
I mean, when it first came out in 2016, that was my cigar of the year. I just thought it was amazing. None of them have lived up to what 2016 did, but it's still a good cigar. So, I do like to see what they do. You know, it's usually a different size each year, kind of a thing for them. So I like that. The other one I would mention is the Mombacho Cosecha.
Okay.
You know, that's a very unique vintage style, you know, all the tobaccos from a particular year, and it's an annual thing. Obviously, he mentioned that there's going to be one coming up that they're going to skip because it just didn't work out for that year. But I think that's a fun project. And I think, you know, that's something that where it's unique enough that it's a good annual kind of a limited release.
Yeah, that's a really good one. I like that one as well. And yeah, that's a case where I give him credit. If he didn't think he had the tobacco to do the release, skip the year. Don't try to force it and come out with an inferior product right now. Okay, so that was – these are one – like the Crux one was a good one. I didn't think of that. And I had that one as well. And it's the – it's the show exclusive is the one I think is the best of all those. I mean, I think you and I agree.
Yes.
That 109 cap or whatever. I think the first one was the best. There's no question. The other ones have been very good. There's nothing, but I think that first one, they just captured lightning in a bottle with that one.
Yep.
Yeah. I had, and I thought you were going to say this one for sure, but maybe June would have said this one is the Singulari, even though some of them have gone regular production.
Yeah, but that's not, I guess, yes, because I'm thinking of, like, something that's every year kind of a thing, and Singulari has kind of skipped a year here
they've
and
skipped
there.
Yeah,
otherwise I would definitely say Singulari, but I did kind of left that out because they had skipped a year here and there. And there was a year where, like, they skipped a year, and then they did, like, two in one year kind of a thing. So, yeah, I would definitely put that on there if you're classifying it as an annual thing.
Yeah, no, I think that's a good one as well. You know, for a while – and I'll get to this is kind of segue. I would say Davidoff Zodiac was in that category and Avo LEs were in that category. I think there's been some changes, unfortunately,
right,
where it's hard to do that. But yeah, I mean, the Singulari was one I was thinking of. I do like the Davidoff one as well. You know, I wasn't a fan of the first Los Calaveras either. Mm-hmm. And I was probably in that minority, but I've liked most of the other Los Calaveras since then by Crown Heads. And there's, you know, so I think that's one that's, it's a good one. They've been doing it now for about 6 or 7 years. I think, you know, so, and some I've liked a lot better than others. So it's, you know, but I think in general, it's one that does well and, you know, it's out there. You know, going back to Dion, I kind of wish he would go back and change it up a little more with some of the blends. Like, I did like that Maduro he did in it. It didn't age well. is what I'll say. It aged terrible, right? But it did. I did like that Maduro. That was like a formal number three cigar of the year when he. That was the 2012. You know, most of them have been that Colorado Cafe wrapper he's used since then on that.
Yeah.
He didn't do one this year, right? He didn't do one this year. Because last year was the Perfecto.
Yeah.
So he didn't do that one this year.
Right.
All right. So here's kind of the juicy question now. How about some of these limited edition annual things that need to just retire?
I will say three different ones. One is, I would just say the whole of the TAA. I don't find there anything that's really enjoyable there anymore. They don't seem to be special. They don't seem to be all that great. I know some people still get a kick out of them, but it's just, to me, I don't understand it anymore. There's a whole bunch that are left over from, you know, 3-4 years ago. They don't sell out. The kind of the concept has been lost, I think, on me. So
Jeff was clearing out the Monte Cristo TAAs at a higher discount rate than the Roma Craft stuff he was clearing out.
Right.
And I'm like, here's the thing. That was I actually thought that was one of the better TAAs, but I agree with you. I think the TAA, I think there's too many. I'd like to see it go back to one or two cigar makers a year. But I'll argue that Pete and La Florida Americana have been pretty consistent with, at least above my palate, they've been consistent there.
You're talking two brands out of what they're up to, like 15 now, something like that they have participating. So it's like, it's not a very good ratio of what's good that's out there. And I think based on our last conversation with Pete, he was kind of moving away from that. So I don't know if he was completely stopping with TA going forward or what the plan was there.
It sounded like he was going to put more into a PCA release but not abandon the TAA. That's kind of how I took it. And I think he made the right call of retiring. It sounded like I heard him on with – he's doing something next year. He's doing another offshoot of Monsters next year, it sounds like, another sampler. Hmm. But the Halloween ones, I think he's reached the point where he did 13 of them. I think that's a good run he had. I think, you know, the first few years were really good. I think the second few years were hit or miss with some of them. And I'm talking about the full-size Halloween release right now.
Right.
But I think he kind of said, I think, you know what, he ran the course with it. In fact, The Bride was the one I really liked. So, so I think he kind of saw it as long enough. And it was maybe time to retire that as well. Same with Ernesto with the short runs. He kind of retired that series at some point. I think he retired it at the right time. He had six or seven of them short runs, and I think it was, you know what, enough's enough. I've heard people say maybe the Camacho Liberty should be retired.
I was gonna say that one,
but I think in fairness they were kind of caught up. They went and re-released a whole bunch of stuff in the last few years, so I still always look forward to a Liberty release to see what they can do. That's just my opinion,
this year's was not good.
I haven't smoked this year.
I
haven't.
Right.
But like last year, they re-released the 2012, and I like that one a lot. So, But the Camacho one and the Avo, those have been around for almost 20 years, both of those. I mean, those are long-time limited releases.
Yeah.
I do like the Zodiac ones. For the most part, I've liked a lot of them. A couple I didn't like, but I think there's an end game with that one. Because they're almost at the end of the Zodiac. So I think there's like two. I think after they just announced Ox and I think Tiger and Rat. No, a Tiger and Rabbit are the last two.
Okay.
So I think there's an end point with that one as well.
Yeah.
With that. So yeah, I could see that one going and being retired. I thought that My Father one was hitting the skids for a while. That's almost been an annual one, but then the Jaime Garcia they released last year I thought was really good.
Yeah.
So the 19, so yeah, I really liked that one. So they kind of came back with that one, and they have my interest on that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But like I guess like there's other companies, like Sokka really doesn't have an annual release. He kind of does a production of each size each year, you know, with the Maestro de Sokka. So that's not, I wouldn't put that into that category at all. But, you know, I'm trying to think of, you know, does General have, General doesn't really have one, and neither does Altidus.
They, to well, I kind of saw this year they did the Macanudo Gold 2020, which I had never heard a year attached to it prior to that.
I had heard that either, yeah.
So it was weird, as if it was like this, it was some like limited, and I think it was like a Bellicoso or something like that. So it was like a limited, I don't know if it was a particular size or something like that, but that was the first year I had ever saw that a year was like attached to it. So I don't know if that was, if that's something they've been doing or not. But
I agree with you on that. The Skip's Craft Series, that's had a couple years off as well. I've liked that. I think that's always a fun one. I kind of wish they'd go back to the ones where they didn't have the molds. Those the Trompeta. Am I saying that?
Yeah.
Is that the, I've always, those have always been, and those, some of those have been really limited has been the problem. So they're really hard to get. You smoked this year's. I didn't smoke this year's. So.
Yeah, I smoked this year's. I thought it was okay. It wasn't great. It wasn't bad. It was just kind of in the middle kind of a thing. So, I mean, you had, you know, the fun thing about it is, I mean, you had the various wrappers on it. So you had some that were like a solid piece for the first half and a solid piece for the second half. And some had some kind of like barber polish style or strips on it and stuff like that. So you could get some variations on it and things like that too. So, another cigar that was an annual release, but now it's kind of starting to get multiple years, is the Firecracker. So there was a annual kind of a thing with that. And then now it's like, you know, you're going to get multiples in a year and people are going to start re-releasing them. So it's kind of, that's starting to, I don't know. It's losing that, I think, uniqueness of the once a year kind of a thing.
Yeah. I mean, what I've liked about the Firecracker, and a lot of those have been really good cigars. They did two this year. I think the Perdomo and HVC. I've liked looking forward to see who's doing it. Is always the fun. And I think there's a third one, because from what I understand, the Sokka, the new Mi Carita Firecracker is a different blend. Like it's even though that, I guess Tricky Traco was based on the original Firecracker, but this, he's got a red banded one, which I, and we'll talk to him about that. I think it's a different blend from what I understand. It's not the same blend that he did. So, I kind of, like I said, I like that one. I like as well. You know, like I said, it's more, and some of, I like better than others, some of the Firecrackers. Like I wasn't a big on the Fratello one. You know, but I had smoked Sokkas. Someone gave me Sokkas with the second batch, and I really liked I really liked that Mi Carita Firecracker. I thought that was a really good cigar. You had that rated.
Yeah, I had the first batch, and I really liked it.
Yeah, it made your list. Yeah,
maybe the best Firecracker.
So, yeah,
pretty good.
Yeah, I agree. I'm trying to see, does anyone say any other lines that we missed? Carlito's there. But I don't think Fuente doesn't really do like an. They have small batches. What they do?
Yeah, I mean they have. They'll attach some years to the. Because they did the charitable boxes, remember?
Yeah. Oh yeah, the Toast Across America. To those, that's a great.
I love
those because there's some great sizes you get from those. Hey, Carlito, we need more Oros, Opus X Oros. You need to do more of those. I love those. So as long as he's listening, I get the Oro is fantastic. Yeah. I thought that was, but I think they're good for, overall. I think they're good for the industry. When you have these, you know, I think they're. I get more excited. I still always get excited when there's a new release from these series because I'm always curious enough to see what it's going to be, how it's going to be different, how it will compare to the previous ones. You know, those are always they're fun. They're fun things to have. And those are the ones I tend to chase down a little more than maybe some other types of limited releases because they're kind of annual as well with them. Yeah. I'm just trying to think if we missed anyone else with that, but I think we hit most of the big ones here tonight.
Yeah, I'm sure there's more, and it just, there's so, you know, so many of them that
yeah,
it's hard to capture them all.
Oops, Coop, will do my best. Thank you, Colin. that cigar is when we were doing Stogie Geek, Paul Asadorian and I bought up a ton of those boxes. Like, I just remember we got our hands on several of those. So, we have different sizes. Yeah. So they would, and they had the different sizes, which was really cool too.
Yeah.
So. Okay. Anything else?
Well, I don't think so.
Okay. Coming up next week on Primetime, we spoke about him a couple of times. Steve Sokka is making a return to Primetime next week. Mm-hmm. So I guess I want to know what he's going to complain to us about to start the show. Because it's going to be there's always the show starts and goes, I got to complain. Right? So I'm dying to hear what the complaint's going to be. And I'm going to
get complaint is going to be about how we all took up his time for the Battle of the Bands.
Oh, I'm going to get crucified. I mean,
you are going to. That'll be it. Coop, how come you're the only one that didn't pick one of my cigars?
I lost. You didn't want to. I lost. So he could prove his point. I ended up losing. Ended up losing on that one. Yeah. So there were a lot of songs I couldn't get. That will be definitely an entertaining show. Bear and I will be on Tuesday night, election night, and cross your fingers, please. I don't have to pull the plug on that show in the middle. But we'll be doing a bunch of cigar topics that night too. Well, it's going to be more. We'll follow the election results. And we'll talk some cigar talk. It's not. If you're going to come in there and like stump for your candidate or complain about the other candidate, please don't come. That's what I'm gonna say.
It's not a political show.
It's not going to be a political show. I already got grief from Jack Tarano saying, "How can you do an election night show without Paul?" I don't know if it's going to work. Bear came up with this idea 3 years ago. Okay.
Yeah.
So. I'm like, and I kind of went back to him. I'm like, you sure you want? He's like, we got to do it. I'm like, all right. So, but we're going to keep it positive like we do. So we got two shows next week. And then tomorrow night, speaking of Battle of the Bands, I'll be drawing the winner for the prize pack. So, I'll be doing that at 8:00. I'm going to do that one live. So, because we had a lot of entries.
Cool.
So we'll do that. And people could see if they won live and please claim your prize in 24 hours so I don't have to chase you down. That's a good prize. That's why we've been chasing down. Like this week we got turnaround right away, which was good on Tuesday. But a couple of I had chased down. I'm like, guys, if you're going to answer, you got to respond. All right. Thanks again to Jean-Michel Louis. Always good talking to him as well. We got through a full baseball season. So are we going into playoffs now? Or are we going into another regular season?
I don't know. That's a good question. I think we're just going to season two.
We're at season two. So I think it will be like 2024 early when we hit the second season if we make it that long.
There you go.
All right. Thanks. Thanks again to our audience as well. Before we go, Carlito's already saying there's some surprises for Christmas. So, stay tuned on more about that. Thanks, Carlito, for tuning in too. So.
Yeah,
we do appreciate that and every one of our audience people who tune in. And Carlito says ratings will go through the roof for Steve Sokka. There may be another show that actually goes higher than that. So,
yeah,
we'll talk about that next week. So, all right, that's going to wrap up Primetime episode 162 into the annals of history for this Thursday, October 29th. Now, Friday, October 30th on the East Coast. We'll see everybody next week. Have a great rest of the evening, everybody.
See you guys.